पलाश कम तो बाहर आ लो तुम्हें लंच मीटिंग ठीक है चलो शुरू।
हेलो, गुड इवनिंग सर। दहिकर
गुड
सर, गुड
इवनिंग, गुड
इवनिंग।
इवनिंग। वडवाईक सर जॉईन झाले होते,
वडवाईक सर आहेत का?
आहे इथे आहेत, व्हिडिओ बंद केलाय त्यांचा मला वाटतं।
अच्छा,
गुड मॉर्निंग सर, गुड आफ्टरनून,
गुड आफ्टरनून सर,
गुड इवनिंग सर,
गुड इवनिंग सर, वेरी गुड इवनिंग।
गुड इवनिंग सर,
गुड इवनिंग सर, वेरी
गुड इवनिंग सर,
गुड इवनिंग। 1116 पार्टिसिपेंट ऑलरेडी जॉइन।
यस सर,
कॉन्फ्रेंस इज गोइंग टू बी वेरी सक्सेसफुल सर।
1117 सर। YouTube लिंक तुम्ही अजून नाही झाली वाटते
कुठले युट्यूब ने ही आज ऑल ही सम मेसेज डिस्प्ले देअर
लिंक तयार झालेली आहे, लिंक झालेली आहे तर सर पाठवायची आहे 3 वर आणि 4th वर।
हो
हो, पाठवा पाठवा।
युट्यूब वर पण चालू झालाय सर ते।
अच्छा मॅडम, मला पाठवून द्या म्हणजे मी त्या ग्रुपवर बाकीच्या ग्रुपवर टाकून देतो।
टाकून देऊ, पाठवू का तुम्हाला?
हो पाठवून द्या ना, म्हणजे आपल्या कॉलेज ग्रुपवर वगैरे। हा, सिनियर कॉलेज ग्रुप।
पॉप्युलर सर तुम्हाला शेअर केलेली आहे लिंक। लिंक शेअर केलेली आहे तुम्हाला
वडवाईक सर?
नाही, माझ्या
व्हॉट्सअप व्हॉट्सअपवर पाठवली आता सर।
बिकॉज वी आर रिसिव्हिंग द मेसेज दॅट वी आर दे आर नॉट रिसिव्हिंग युट्यूब चॅनल लिंक।
प्रिन्सिपल सर तुम्हाला पण सेंड केलेली आहे।
हो सचिन, यू रन दॅट व्हिडिओ आफ्टर 5 मिनिट, यू कॅन डू दॅट।
हियर वी कंटिन्यू नो।
हां, Sir, I just sent this link on other groups, college groups, senior college groups, STAMI and other groups, so that they can join our conference.
Smita ma'am is going to join. Just she will join.
शिक्षा ही समाज के नैतिक मूल्यों को स्थापित करती है। शिक्षा ही राष्ट्र निर्माण का सबसे प्रभावी संबल है। शिक्षा के प्रसार की महान सेवा का एक अविरत दीप स्तंभ है अमर सेवा मंडल, जिसे प्रज्वलित किया था सुप्रसिद्ध समाज सेवी, शिक्षाविद एवं दूरदृष्टा स्वर्गीय गोविंद राव बंजारी ने। प्रत्येक व्यक्ति प्राप्ति का अधिकार रखता है। उसके लिए जाति, धर्म, आर्थिक स्थिति, व्यवसाय, ये समस्त दायरे कोई मायने नहीं रखते। इस हेतु से प्रत्येक व्यक्ति को शिक्षा मिले, जिससे व्यक्ति नहीं बल्कि व्यक्तित्व का सृजन हो, यह विचारधारा थी स्वर्गीय श्री गोविंद राव बंजारी की।
1983 साली अंधारी साहेबांनी या कॉलेजची स्थापना केली। अंधारी साहेब शिक्षणापासून वंचित राहिले होते परिस्थितीमुळे, आणि त्यामुळे असं त्यांना असं वाटलं, कुठेतरी अशी तीव्र इच्छा त्यांच्या मनामध्ये निर्माण झाली की जी अवस्था जी आपल्या वाट्याला आली ती इथल्या भागातल्या लोक मुलांच्या वाट्याला येऊ नये, आणि म्हणून त्यांना उच्च शिक्षण आपण दिलं पाहिजे या उद्देशाने त्यांनी या संस्थेची स्थापना केली। शिक्षणाला अतिशय प्राधान्य आणि डिसिप्लिन अतिशय महत्त्वाची। सगळ्यांचं सहकार्य असल्याशिवाय आपली स्वप्न आपण पूर्ण करू शकत नाही। सगळ्यांचं सहकार्य लागते खालपासून वरपर्यंत। जेव्हा सगळी माणसं जीव तोडून त्याच्यामध्ये स्वतःला झोकून देतात तेव्हा ते काम यशस्वी होते। आणि या कॉलेजमध्ये असा सगळ्यांचा आम्हाला खूप मिळालेला आहे सहभाग। हे साहेबांचं स्वप्न आहे आणि अभिजित तर नवीन काळाचं आहे। नवीन काळाला काय काय गरज आहे नवीन काळाची ते सगळं त्याला माहिती आहे, आणि त्या दृष्टीने या कॉलेजमध्ये महत्त्वाची भर पडली आहे आणि पुढेसुद्धा पडणार आहे।
अमर सेवा मंडल का दिव्य प्रवास प्रारंभ हुआ 12 सितंबर 1984 के सूर्योदय के साथ, जब कमला नेहरू महाविद्यालय के रूप में शिक्षा का एक छोटा सा बीज अंकुरित हुआ। पूर्व प्रधानमंत्री स्वर्गीय राजीव गांधी के करकमलों द्वारा जिसका उद्घाटन किया गया। प्रारंभ से ही मैत्रीपूर्ण वातावरण, कौशल्यपूर्ण अध्यापन एवं संस्कारपूर्ण अध्ययन के मार्ग पर कमला नेहरू महाविद्यालय अग्रेसर होता रहा, जिसके कारण आज यह संपूर्ण मध्य भारत का आदर्श शिक्षा संस्थान माना जाता है। यहां कला, वाणिज्य तथा विज्ञान संकाय में विद्यार्थी सर्वोत्तम शिक्षा से लाभान्वित हो रहे हैं। इस भव्य वास्तु में विज्ञान शाखा के सामान्य विषयों के अलावा इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स, कंप्यूटर साइंस, बायोटेक्नोलॉजी, माइक्रोबायोलॉजी, कॉस्मेटिक टेक्नोलॉजी, पर्यावरण विज्ञान इत्यादि विशेष शाखाओं की पदवी का भी प्रयोजन है। कमला नेहरू महाविद्यालय की सफलता में विशेष उपलब्धि के रूप में डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एमसीए और एमबीए का विशेष उल्लेख करना होगा। अनेक प्रकार की गतिविधियों का यह केंद्र विद्यार्थियों को व्यवस्थापन के अंतरिम तथा प्रायोगिक पहलुओं से अवगत कराता है। विगत 3 दशकों से भी अधिक काल शिक्षा के माध्यम से जागरूकता एवं सेवा का कार्य करने के लिए प्रतिबद्ध अमर सेवा मंडल द्वारा विभिन्न अभ्यासक्रमों के अलग अलग अनेक महाविद्यालय प्रारंभ किए गए, ताकि युवा वर्ग समय की आवश्यकता एवं अपनी क्षमता के आधार पर अपना भविष्य निर्धारित कर सके। अभियांत्रिकी इस सदी की आवश्यकता है, अतः आज की पीढ़ी इस अभ्यासक्रम की ओर खींची जा रही है। परंतु अंधी दौड़ को दरकिनार कर देश के एवं विद्यार्थियों के उज्जवल भविष्य के निर्माण के लिए पूरे समर्पण एवं संकल्प के साथ कार्यरत है गोविंद राव वंजारी कॉलेज ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग एंड टेक्नोलॉजी। प्राचीन काल में शिक्षा के लिए उपयुक्त वातावरण में शांत एवं प्राकृतिक सानिध्य में गुरुकुल के माध्यम से अध्ययन होता था, वैसा ही परिवेश है गोविंद राव वंजारी कॉलेज ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग एंड टेक्नोलॉजी का। नागपुर शहर के एकदम करीब मगर शहर की चहल पहल से दूर प्रकृति की मनोरम सुंदरता में यह भव्य इमारत सहज ही आकर्षित एवं प्रभावित करती है। अध्ययन के लिए पूर्ण रूप से अनुकूल मैकेनिकल, इलेक्ट्रिकल, इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स, कंप्यूटर सभी संकायों की प्रयोगशालाएं अपने आप में सुसज्ज एवं विद्यार्थियों को परिपूर्ण अनुभव एवं ज्ञान देने के लिए सक्षम है। यह महाविद्यालय मात्र इंजीनियरिंग की शिक्षा देने वाला महाविद्यालय नहीं अपितु समाज सेवा का अनुपम उदाहरण भी है। यहाँ विद्यार्थियों की आर्थिक परिस्थिति को मद्देनजर रखकर उन्हें विभिन्न आधारों पर रियायतें भी दी जाती हैं। आधुनिकतम किताबों, जर्नल्स एवं रिसर्च पेपर से युक्त विशाल लाइब्रेरी, ई लाइब्रेरी, कम्युनिटी ऑडिटोरियम, समय समय पर आयोजित कार्यशालाएं, विभिन्न खेलों तथा एथलेटिक्स की सुविधाएं, सांस्कृतिक आयोजन इत्यादि विद्यार्थियों के सर्वांगीण उन्नति के लिए पूरक परिवेश का निर्माण करते हैं। यह एक ऐसा गुरुकुल है जहां दीवारों में ईंटों के बीच संस्कारों का सीमेंट भरा है, जहां ज्ञान की पावन हवा में सांस ली जाती है, जहां व्यक्तित्व निर्माण ही सबसे बड़ा लक्ष्य है, जहां सामाजिक महत्व नहीं अनुशासन ही प्राथमिकता है। अमर सेवा मंडल के अन्य समस्त महाविद्यालयों की तरह ही गोविंद राव वंजारी कॉलेज ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग एंड टेक्नोलॉजी का पूरी तरह वर्ग अपने ज्ञान से नहीं अपितु अपने आचरण एवं व्यवहार से देश के तकनीकी भविष्य का निर्माण करने के लिए संकल्पबद्ध है। विद्यार्थियों का भविष्य एवं सुरक्षा देखते हुए अमर सेवा मंडल द्वारा इन सभी महाविद्यालयों में सिर्फ पदवीधर विद्यार्थी ही नहीं चेतनाभिमुख ज्ञान संपन्न राष्ट्र के प्रहरी निर्माण किए जाते हैं।
एजुकेशन फॉर ऑल की संकल्पना के साथ में मेरे फादर स्वर्गीय गोविंदराव जी वंजारी, इन्होंने कमला नेहरू महाविद्यालय की स्थापना की। डिसिप्लिन और अपने एकेडमिक्स के बलबूते पर विदर्भ के जाने माने महाविद्यालयों की पंक्ति में कमला नेहरू महाविद्यालय का नाम शामिल हो गया। कमला नेहरू महाविद्यालय के साथ साथ उसी के बुनियाद पर हमने इस संस्था का विस्तारीकरण किया। हमने इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज की स्थापना की, पॉलिटेक्निक कॉलेज शुरू किया, हमने लॉ कॉलेज शुरू किया, फार्मेसी कॉलेज की स्थापना की, हमने एजुकेशन की स्थापना की, MBA MCA जैसे कोर्सेज शुरू किए और उसका विस्तारीकरण के साथ साथ एक अच्छा एजुकेशन देने का प्रयास आज हमारे संस्था के सभी महाविद्यालय, फिर चाहे वो एकेडमिक्स एक्टिविटी हो, स्पोर्ट्स एंड कल्चर हो, प्लेसमेंट हो, इंडस्ट्रियल लिंकेजेस हो, रिसर्च एक्टिविटीज़ हो, इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर हो, इन सभी मामलों की गतिविधियों में अग्रेसर है और एक अच्छा बेस्ट एजुकेशन देने का प्रयास हमारी संस्था के माध्यम से है। मैं चाहता हूँ कि विदर्भ के विद्यार्थी इस महाविद्यालय में अपना प्रवेश ले और वो इस संधि का लाभ ले और मैं अपने संस्था की ओर से अपने माध्यम से विद्यार्थियों के उज्जवल भविष्य के लिए उनको शुभकामनाएं देता हूँ। धन्यवाद।
गोविंद राव वंजारी कॉलेज ऑफ लॉ विधि संकाय का यह महाविद्यालय अपने प्रकार का एकमात्र माना जाता है। भविष्य के कुशल अधिवक्ताओं के निर्माण हेतु डिबेट एसोसिएशन, लीगल एड सेंटर तथा मूट कोर्ट जैसी रचनात्मक व्यवस्थाएं यहाँ की गई हैं। कम्युनिकेशन, व्यक्तित्व विकास, करियर गाइडेंस एवं अन्य विषयों पर मार्गदर्शन यहाँ की विशेष गतिविधियां हैं। इसके साथ साथ पर्यावरण के प्रति सचेत समाज का निर्माण यह ध्येय समक्ष रखते हुए एनवायरमेंट सेल यह गोविंद राव वंजारी कॉलेज ऑफ लॉ की विशिष्ट पहचान है। शहर से लगकर ही शहर की आपाधापी से दूर स्थित कमला नेहरू कॉलेज ऑफ फार्मेसी अपनी अलग पहचान रखता है। पूर्णतः नियोजित प्रयोगशालाएं, सर्वोत्तम उपकरण, अंतर्राष्ट्रीय शोध पत्र, नवीनतम CD एवं किताबों से सज्ज लाइब्रेरी, 24 घंटे इंटरनेट सुविधा, यह समस्त आधुनिकतम सुविधाएं इस महाविद्यालय को विशेष बनाती हैं। स्मिता वंजारी अमर सेवा मंडल इस संस्था की कोषाध्यक्ष हैं, साथ ही संस्था विकासाभिमुख समस्त प्रकल्पों में वे विशेष ध्यान देकर उन्हें नियंत्रित करती हैं। साथ ही वुमन सेल के माध्यम से विद्यार्थियों के सर्वांगीण विकास कार्यक्रमों का नियोजन भी वे करती हैं।
In today's scenario of unemployment, it is moral responsibility of all educational institutions to develop the student for their employment as well as making them good entrepreneur. We mainly concentrate on our training and placement division to help our student to make their career in the respective area. Over the period of time,
we have been associated with so many
multinational companies like TCS, Wipro, Eureka Forbes, Kearney International, Infosys, HDFC, Mahindra & Mahindra and others. We are looking forward to more industrial linkage for better
experience. Very, very good evening.
We have also signed up MOU with Huddersfield University, UK, and also looking forward for more tie-up with international universities for exchange of education of our student. We hope that this kind of efforts of Vanzari Group will surely help students to make their career bright.
यही नहीं, अमर सेवा मंडल की ओर से कामकाजी महिलाओं तथा विद्यार्थिनियों के लिए संपूर्ण आधुनिक सुविधाओं से युक्त कमला नेहरू गर्ल्स एवं वर्किंग वुमेन्स हॉस्टल अपने आप में एक विशेष उपलब्धि है। संस्था के सक्करदरा स्थित कमला नेहरू गर्ल्स हॉस्टल व प्रियदर्शिनी गर्ल्स हॉस्टल में बाहर से आई हुई विद्यार्थिनियों के लिए अत्याधुनिक सुविधाओं की विशेष व्यवस्था है। किताबी शिक्षा के अतिरिक्त विद्यार्थियों के व्यक्तित्व में निखार लाना शिक्षा का मूलभूत उद्देश्य है। यह अमर सेवा मंडल की विचारधारा है। इस दृष्टि से विभिन्न स्पर्धाओं का आयोजन, प्राध्यापकों का विद्यार्थियों से विशेष आत्मिक संबंध एवं नवीनतम तकनीकी सुविधाओं की उपलब्धता यहाँ के महत्वपूर्ण पहलू हैं। जहाँ एक ओर शिक्षा का क्षेत्र व्यावसायिकता, कृत्रिमता एवं औपचारिकता से बोझिल होता जा रहा है, वहीं अपनी प्रामाणिक प्रतिबद्धता के साथ नैतिकता का पाठ पढ़ाने वाले अध्यापकों का निर्माण भी अमर सेवा मंडल कर रहा है, गोविंदराव वंजारी कॉलेज ऑफ एजुकेशन के माध्यम से। पढ़ाना यह मात्र किताबी ज्ञान को बांटने का काम नहीं, बल्कि सर्वांगीण विकास के समस्त पहलुओं से विद्यार्थियों को अवगत कराना होता है। इस आधार पर बीएड, एमएड, डीटीएड इन सभी पाठ्यक्रमों का अध्यापन नैसर्गिक सौंदर्ययुक्त सौहार्दपूर्ण वातावरण में यहाँ होता है। यह महाविद्यालय समाज के सशक्त प्रहरियों को निर्माण करने वाले शिक्षकों के निर्माण का कटिबद्ध स्रोत है। विद्यादान सबसे बड़ी सेवा है, और इसके साथ जब सामाजिक सेवा का अभियान जुड़ जाता है, तब अमर सेवा मंडल जैसी संस्थाएं प्रेरक मार्गदर्शक बनकर समाज का, देश का मार्गदर्शन करने के लिए आदर्श मानी जाती है। यह बरगद यूं ही खिलता रहे, जिसकी छांव में अन्य महत्कार्य फलते फूलते रहें, यही समय की आवश्यकता है।
हौसला दिल में है, साथ है ज्ञान,
हम समाज की, देश की शान।
हौसला दिल में है, साथ है ज्ञान,
हम समाज की, देश की शान।
We move to build the nation, we redefine education. We move to build the nation, we redefine education.
शिक्षा के अंधेरे ना पले,
हर घर में ज्ञान का दीप जले,
शिक्षा के अंधेरे ना पले।
जीवन के लक्ष्य को पाने हम पढ़ते चले, बढ़ते चले।
We move to build the nation, we redefine education. We move to build the nation, we redefine education.
मैडम गुड इवनिंग।
गुड इवनिंग सर। गुड इवनिंग।
गुड इवनिंग मैम। चीफ गेस्ट ऑलरेडी जॉइंड मैम।
गुड इवनिंग मैडम।
अग्निहोत्री सर।
गुड इवनिंग मैम। गुड इवनिंग। गुड इवनिंग।
गुड इवनिंग मैडम। नमस्कार।
नमस्कार सर। नमस्कार।
अग्निहोत्री सर नमस्कार।
सर नमस्कार एंड वेरी गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स हियर ऑन दिस पैनल।
थैंक यू सर।
अनुपम अग्निहोत्री।
Our trustee sir, Dr. Smita Vanjari ma'am already joined.
This is Smita Vanjari.
Shall we begin, sir?
You continue, ma'am.
Good evening to all excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me a great pleasure to extend a very warm welcome on behalf of Department of Physics and Department of Electronics, Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, Nagpur, who has clubbed all of us for the International Conference on Smart Materials Application to Devices. A 2 days conference is going to be fully international and it is conducted on a digital platform in line with the social distancing norms due to COVID-19 pandemic. With this noble thought, let us start this evening by lighting the lamp in front of Goddess Saraswati. I request Honorable Dr. Mrs. Smita Vanjari Madam to light the lamp.
गुरुत्वं कल्याणं आरोग्यं धनसंपदः शुभं गुरुत्वं कल्याणं आरोग्यं धनसंपदः शत्रुबुद्धि विनाशाय दीपज्योतिर्नमोस्तुते दीपज्योतिर्नमोस्तुते शुभं गुरुत्वं कल्याणं आरोग्यं धनसंपदः शुभं गुरुत्वं कल्याणं आरोग्यं धनसंपदः।
Goddess Saraswati is a symbol of knowledge, music, art, wisdom and nature. May the divine power blesses all of us. Thank you, ma'am. Before the commencement of the inaugural function, I pay my homage to late Sri Govindrawji Vanjari, visionary great leader and founder president of Amar Seva Mandal. He is encouragement, enthusiasm, and excellency is one of the major aspects of our organization. With an object of encouraging the spirit of research and innovations, myself feels proud to host this conference. This event is not just a single day routine, rather than it is a composition of 5 international national conferences, each specialized in specific knowledge areas. It was also accompanied with one FDP where we have received a very huge response of nearly 7,000 participants. At the outset, I feel honored to welcome Honorable Dr. Srimati Suhasini Vanjari Madam, President of Amar Seva Mandal, who is always a guiding spirit and source of inspiration for us. I welcome Honorable MLC Advocate Abhijit Vanjari, sir, Secretary of Amar Seva Mandal, a prestigious education society in Nagpur, and under whose dynamic leadership Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya is progressing. Today, due to unavoidable circumstances, sir could not attend this function. So, on the behalf of Honorable Advocate Abhijit Vanjari, sir, I request Honorable Dr. Mrs. Smita Vanjari, madam, to preside over this today's function. Ma'am is a treasurer of Amar Seva Mandal. Ma'am also a senate member of RTMNU and actively involved in the college administration. And she is a source of encouragement for us. So I request ma'am to preside over the today's function. I welcome Honorable Dr. Anupam Agnihotri, सर डायरेक्टर जवाहरलाल नेहरू एल्युमिनियम रिसर्च डेवलपमेंट एंड डिजाइन सेंटर एज ए चीफ गेस्ट फॉर दिस फंक्शन. I feel privileged to extend my warm welcome to keynote speaker, Honorable Dr. Joshi sir from USA and all eminent scientists from different countries, Honorable Dr. Karanjikar sir from USA, Honorable Professor Pode sir from Korea, Honorable Dr. Kafle sir from Nepal, Honorable Dr. Kaushik sir from USA, who are going to share their experience and knowledge with us. I welcome Dr. Badwai sir, Principal of Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, Professor Baker sir, Vice Principal, and Professor Kukpalwar, convener of the conference. Once again, I welcome you all to be present here for the celebration of this event. 2 days International Conference on Smart Materials Application to Devices aims to bring together leading academic scientists, researchers, and research scholars to exchange and share their experiences and research results on all aspects of materials, smart materials, and their applications in devices. I invite Professor Kukpalwar, convener of this conference, for the welcome speech and to focus on the theme of the conference.
Thank you, ma'am. Am I audible, ma'am? Ma'am, yes, sir, am yes, I
sir.
Audible?
Yes, sir.
Oh. Good evening, one and all present here. And thank you for joining us at the 2 days online International Conference 2021 on Smart Materials Applications to Devices. I am Dr. Suresh Kukpalwar, convener of this virtual international conference, jointly organized by Department of Physics and Department of Electronics, Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, Nagpur. First of all, I pay my homage to great visionary leader, founder president of this institution, late Sri Govindrawji Vanzari. It is my immense pleasure and privilege to welcome on this occasion Honorable Dr. Srimati Suhasini Vanzari, President Amar Seva Mandal, Nagpur, whose guidance and blessings are always with us. I would like to welcome Advocate Abhijit Vanzari, MLC and Secretary Amar Seva Mandal, Nagpur, whose dynamic leadership always gives us constant inspiration to arrange such type of events. Just I told Professor Khrabi ma'am, our Secretary Abhijit Vanzari sir, could not attend this function due to some reasons. I would like to welcome now president of this function, Honorable Dr. Smita Vanzari, Treasurer Amar Seva Mandal, Nagpur, and Senate Member, RTM Nagpur University, Nagpur. I would like to welcome on the behalf of Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, the chief guest of the inaugural function of this international conference, Dr. Anupam Agnihotri, Director, Jawaharlal Nehru Aluminium Research Development and Design Center, Nagpur. I welcome our principal, Dr. Dilip Badwaik, and vice principal, Dr. Pradeep Dahikar, for their time-to-time support to organize this online conference. I would like to welcome here all the respected resource persons from abroad who will share their knowledge about their research work on materials and enhance our mental horizon in this pandemic situation. I welcome here organizing secretary Professor Mrs. Vandana Kharabe, Head Department of Physics, co-convener, and all the organizing committee members and all my colleagues. I especially welcome here all the participants from various institutions, from various places in India and abroad. The participants are registered from most of the regions, almost all states of India. Besides India, the participants are registered from other countries also, like Iran, South Korea, Dubai, Bangladesh, Tunisia, Nigeria, and Nepal. This conference holds special value because the entire conference is taking place on a digital platform. Due to changing time caused by COVID-19, we encourage our participants to stay safe and maintain social distancing, as a result of which this conference will be conducted remotely through the use of advanced technologies such as augmented reality and virtual reality. Without afraid of COVID-19, just we can consider challenges of COVID-19 and turn it to opportunities. We never thought such situation will occur, and we all will be online. We ourselves improved and accepted the importance of technology and are going to become techno-savvy. So I think we should accept the challenges given by COVID-19 to convert into opportunities. Our college accepted this and organized international level virtual conference. The aim and objective of this e-conference is to provide a world-class platform to present and discuss all the latest research and results of scientists related smart materials and their applications in the electronic devices. New materials hold the key to fundamental advances in energy conversion and storage. These materials can be applied for production of the devices with the help of electronic techniques. This conference provides opportunities for the different areas delegates to exchange new ideas and applications, experiences, face-to-face, online, through internet, using different apps which are now available, to establish business or research relations, and to find global partners for future collaboration. We hope that the conference results constitute a significant contribution to the knowledge in this up-to-date scientific field. The conference will be held to make it an ideal platform for people to share views and experiences related science and technology areas. I also serve to foster communication among researchers and practitioners working in a wide variety of scientific areas with a common interest in improving and enhancing materials and related techniques. This online conference consists of invited talks on the focal theme as well as in allied areas to promote research and education in physics and electronics, to create awareness about new innovations among concerned students, research scholars, and teachers. This is the 2 days virtual conference. In today's session, there will be keynote address followed by inaugural function. The keynote address will be delivered by Professor Ashok Joshi, a well-recognized innovator and high technology entrepreneur, USA. Followed by keynote address, there will be one invited talk by Dr. Mukund Karanjikar, President, Technology Holding, Salt Lake City, University of Texas, USA. On next day, The session will be start at 3 p.m. First invited talk will be delivered by Professor Ramchandra Pode, Professor, Department of Physics, Kyung-hee University, Seoul, Republic of Korea. Second invited talk will be at 4 p.m. by Dr. Bhim Prasad Kafle, Assistant Professor, Department of Chemical Science and Engineering, Kathmandu University, Kathmandu, Nepal. After two talks, there will be a small tea break. And the third and last invited talk will be at 5:30 p.m. and delivered by Dr. Ajit Kaushik, Assistant Professor of Chemistry, Polytechnic University, Florida, USA. I ensure that all the sessions on both the days will be fruitful for everyone present here, especially for young researchers and scholars. The speciality of this conference is that, means according to me, all the speakers are from abroad and Indian origin. So enjoy this virtual conference and announce the knowledge. Thank you. Thank you very much. Jai. Over to ma'am. Kharabi ma'am.
Madam, please unmute.
Audible?
Yes.
Thank you, sir, for elaborating conference details. Now I request Dr. Badwaik, sir, principal of Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, to give introductory remarks. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
A very good afternoon, one and all. At outset, I would like to pay humble tribute to great visionary leader, let's say Govind Rao Ji Vanjari, founder president Amar Swamandal. On the behalf of Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, I, Dr. Dilip Badwaik, principal of the college, extend a warm welcome to all the respected guests, academicians, faculty members, research scholars, and dear students on the occasion of inaugural function of International Conference on Smart Materials Application to Devices. This conference is jointly organized by Department of Physics, Electronics of Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, Nagpur. This inaugural function is presided over by Honorable Dr. Smita Vanjari, ma'am, Treasurer Amar Swamandal, and Senate member RTM Nagpur University, Nagpur. And Honorable MLC Advocate Abhijit Vanjari, sir, could not grace the dais because of some urgent meetings he is having, but he convey his best wishes for this international conference. Chief guest, Honorable Dr. Anupam Agnihotri, sir, Director, Jawaharlal Nehru Aluminium Research, Development and Design Center, Nagpur. In this international conferences, we have five speakers. Two speakers will deliver expert talk today and three will deliver tomorrow. And these expert persons are Honorable Dr. Ashok Joshi from USA, Honorable Dr. Mukund Karanjikar from USA. Both these experts are delivering expert talk today itself. Then Honorable Dr. R.B. Pode, sir, Department of Physics, Kyung-hee University, Seoul Campus, Republic of Korea. Honorable Dr. Bhim Prasad Kafle, Assistant Professor, Department of Chemical Science and Engineering, Kathmandu University, Nepal. Honorable Ajit Kaushik, sir, Assistant Professor of Chemistry, Department of Natural Sciences, Florida Polytechnic University, USA. Vice Principal of our college, Dr. Pradeep Dahikar, Convener Dr. Suresh Pupulwar, Organizing Committee members, all participants from different colleges across India and abroad too. Once again, I welcome you with my words in this little bit sunny evening. Friends, we are facing unprecedented challenges due to COVID-19 pandemic since March 2020. We already faced coronavirus wave 1, currently facing wave 2. And as the experts are discussing in the newspaper and news channel. In future, shortly, we have to face wave 3 and wave 4. Being responsible citizen, we have to obey the norms issued by the government and ICMR. So stay home, stay safe. Friends, don't be afraid of the worst situation and find out the opportunities in them. It is rightly said that every bad situation is an opportunity to get stronger, better, and build ourselves up. This pandemic provides us opportunity to update ourselves, to overcome this worst ever situation, and to fulfill academic thrust of faculties. We have organized number of webinars on various topics. Recently, we have organized 1 week national faculty development program on research methodology. We get overwhelming response for this FDP. Then we have organized international webinar on stock market and investment and career opportunity. Then day before yesterday, we have organized national conference on emerging trends of life sciences in view of current pandemic situation. And today is this international conference on smart material application to devices. And few more conferences we are going to organize in coming days. Thus, the pandemic situation provide us opportunity to attend online webinars sitting at the comfort of our home. The International Conference on Smart Materials Application to Devices. Smart materials are the materials that are manipulated to respond in a controllable and reversible way, modifying some of their properties as a result of external stimuli such as external mechanical stress, temperature, and so on. Because of their responsiveness, smart materials are also known as responsive materials. Now, there are many examples where smart materials are used. There are cloths which we can wear. The color of that cloths can be changed as the temperature goes on changing. Such cloths are now available in the market. Similarly, sports wear with ventilation valve that react to the temperature and humidity by opening when wearer breaks out in the sweat and closing, that valve will close when the body cools down. Building adapt to the atmospheric condition. Now the pens are there, which are using the smart materials. Now that buildings adapt to atmospheric conditions such as wind, heat, rain, and about drugs that are released into the bloodstream as soon as the viral infection is detected. Safe memory material. This is another example where the smart materials can be used. They have the ability to change the shape, even returning to their original shape when exposed to the heat source. Chromoactive materials. These are the glasses which we are using in our spectacle. They change color. The spectacle glass change the color when certain external parameter changes, such as when the light intensity change, glass color will change. When the temperature of the surrounding change, glass color will change. Even the pressure change, glass color will be changed. Synthetic spider web. This material is not only 5 times greater or stronger than the steel, but also has great elasticity. Flexible is there. Its potential use includes bulletproof clothing, artificial skin for burns, and waterproof adhesive. Graphene is the next example. Its potential uses are almost unlimited. Batteries with more autonomy, cheaper photovoltaic solar cell, faster computers, flexible electronic devices, more resistance building, bioionic limbs, etc. All these is possible thanks to their multiple properties. All these are the application of the smart materials. This conference will definitely provide an ideal platform and opportunity to share research ideas and edge-cutting issues with the eminent scientist, academician, and brainstorming discussion within this expert talk will result into fruitful outcomes that will be used for the betterment of society and ultimately the nation too. Under the dynamic leadership of respected Dr. Suhasini Vanjari ma'am, President Amar Seva Mandal, Honorable MLC, Advocate Abhijit Dada Vanjari, Secretary Amar Seva Mandal, and Honorable Dr. Smita Vanjari ma'am, Treasurer Amar Seva Mandal, our Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya continue to attains a new height. As a result, our Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya is re-accredited A+ grade with CGPA 3.53 in its third cycle of re-accreditation. Our college offers 9 graduation courses, 22 PG courses, 2 postgraduate diploma, 6 higher learning and research centers that includes physics, chemistry, electronics, computer science, commerce, and English. From our center, 30 students are so far, presently, 30 students are registered for their PhD, and many more have awarded PhD degree from our center. In the past 5 years, we have published around 300 research papers in the journals of national and international reputes. We are imparting education to around 8,000 students, that includes junior college too. We always strive hard for the academic excellence and overall development of our students. College is also having international collaborations. More than 1,000 participants have registered for this international conference. And we can see around 200 participants are already attending this Zoom platform. And many more are watching the live streaming of this international conference on Kamala Nehru YouTube channel. I hope this conference will definitely aid to the participants' knowledge. Wishing great success to this international conference. Thank you. Thank you very much. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you very much, sir, for your effective introductory remarks. And you have illustrated the conference theme in a much detailed manner. Thank you, sir, again.
Thank you, ma'am.
I consider a great honor to introduce Honorable Dr. Anupam Agnihotri, sir, Director, Jawaharlal Nehru Aluminium Research Development and Design Center, Nagpur, on this occasion, being a chief guest for this function. Sir is an IIT alumnus of IIT Kanpur. He has completed his Doctor of Philosophy degree in Materials and Metallurgical Engineering from VNIT. Sir has served visiting faculty in the University of Quebec in Canada, as well as Hungarian Research Institute under United Nations Development Program. Sir is deeply involved in research activities on aluminium technology related to energy audit, environmental monitoring, modernization programs, low-cost materials alternatives. Sir has published many research papers in reputed journals, and more than 10 patents are credited to his accounts. Dr. Agnihotri, sir, is working presently as a director at Jawaharlal Nehru Aluminium Research Development and Design Center, Nagpur. Sir is a member of Aluminium Mission Plan 2012 to 2022 under Ministry of Mines. Sir is an sector expert in aluminium for National Mission of Enhanced Energy Efficiency Programs under Ministry of Power. Sir is a board member of Aluminium Association of India. Sir is an Indian Institute of Metals, as a member of Indian Society for Non-Destructive Testing. So with such profound background of this, I request Honorable Dr. Agnihotri, sir, to deliver his inaugural speech on this occasion. So let us have a pleasure of listening opening remarks from the today's chief guest. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Am I audible?
Yes, yeah, sir. Very much.
Thank you for that. Dignitaries on this VC panel, Dr. Srimati Smita Vanjari, Trustee and Treasurer Amar Seva Mandal, Dr. D.S. Badwai, Principal Professor Dehikar, Vice Principal Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, Professor Pupalwar, Convener ICS MAD 2021, invitees, speakers, participants, faculty members, students, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, a very good evening. Must be a good morning for the speakers who are in US. So at the outset, I extend warm greetings to all of you here. And in fact, it is honor and pleasure to be part of this inauguration function of International Conference on Smart Materials Application to Devices, also known as ICS MAD 2021. I'm grateful to Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya Nagpur and Management Committee of this International Conference for this opportunity to address the allied gathering. Guru se gyan, gyan se samman, samman se man. Is maan ke liye main aap sabhi ka hardik abhinandan karta hoon. On my personal behalf and behalf of my institute, which is Jawaharlal Nehru Alumni Research Development and Design Center, it is an autonomous body under Ministry of Mines. I congratulate the entire physics and electronics department for successfully organizing this ICS MAD 2021. To me, it seems to be a real international conference, that is international conference in true sense, since I can see that speakers are from all over the globe. Friends, as the previous speakers have also mentioned, that the world is facing humanity's biggest crisis since World War II. And almost every country has been affected by the devastating coronavirus disease, also known as COVID-19. With my experience in last 1 year, I can say that we can overcome this disease with 4 rules, that is personal distancing, wearing masks, maintaining hygiene, and the latest is vaccination. There is no other way out. So take care, be safe, and my personal request to all of you is follow the government's norm to deal with this COVID-19. Friends, you must be aware, it's known to everybody now that the world has entered fourth industrial revolution, where everybody is looking for innovation. See, the word is innovation. And if you see innovation in a very simple words, it is nothing but a process to create something new that makes life better. Presently, what I can think of, the best example is internet that has made life better than when it was before that. Aircraft, latest is solar power. So these are the examples of innovation which are done, which are created to make life better. And in fact, the latest addition to that will be the COVID-19 vaccine, which is also to make life better. And if you see the innovation, what exactly makes innovation possible? Innovation is possible by nothing less than all little failures we come across, irrelevances, trivialities, and not quite solved mysteries. No doubt, initially it seems to be messy, but at the end, it's something very awesome. The good news is that innovation is a skill, something that can be taught, that can be nurtured, and of course, that can be coached. So at the end of the day, if it's a skill, then innovation is all about people, and that's the resource India has in abundance. As India embraces a true culture of innovation, there's no telling what we can achieve. As a teacher and leaders, we must inspire, support, challenge, and also reward so that students strive for innovation. Friends, if we see what's happening at a global level when it comes to innovation, and the good news is, in fact, I'm proud to share with you that India's Global Innovation Index, that is a ranking among 131 countries, has moved up to 48th position last year, that is in 2020, from 60th position in 2017. So in 3 years, it has come up 12 ranks up the ladder. So now, we as India as a country are among top 50 countries in field of innovation, and I can say that India has started innovating. So when we talk about this Industrial Revolution 4.0, the most important factor which I think I consider is the time. When compared with the previous Industrial Revolution, this one, that is the fourth one, is evolving at an exponential pace rather than linear pace. So we have to have technologies which can be developed in short time. And for that, we have to have a multidisciplinary approach. Or I can say that in this era of IR 4.0, Industrial Revolution 4.0, this will be marked by fusion of disciplines, combining the engineering, digital, and biological worlds. So if we have to work at exponential pace, then only way is to have materials with multiple variable properties, which are also known as smart materials. Otherwise, what will happen? We may miss the bus, we may lose the pace of revolution. These smart materials are latest revolution in the field of material science, and of course, an integral part of IR 4.0. So innovation and smart materials go hand in hand, and it is difficult to say that innovations are leading smart material, or the vice versa, that is, smart materials are leading the innovations. I'm not expert in this field of smart materials, but I can give you an example. One of the materials we have come across that was also mentioned by the principal at Vadwai, that is graphene. To us, it was part of an alloy development program. It was aluminum alloy reinforced with graphene flakes to get superior properties. I mean, this was something we cannot imagine of, the kind of properties we got. And what I think, this kind of material is going to revolutionize the future of industries. The output was a material with high thermal and electrical conductivity, enormous density, ultra light. Being working in aluminium, we always look for materials which are light, more flexible and malleable, I mean, better than carbon fiber. And of course, at the last, we look for the strength, and this graphene, or the output what we had, was stronger than the steel. So for us, it was smart. More than smart, it was kind of a wonder material. So in short, I can say that smart materials' potential uses are also unlimited. I mean, the list is unlimited. If you name it, there are many of them. But I can share what I can foresee the future application of smart materials in all the fields of life is there. That's the kind of potential they have. And to share a few of them is think of an aero industry. So once upon a time, when I joined this institute, I was proud that aircraft is made up of aluminium, and I'm fortunate to work on a metal that is used for making aircrafts. You won't believe, those times, the aircraft used to be made of 70% aluminium alloy, and rest of the things, rest of the different metal on the material. Today, things have changed, and that 70% has come down to almost 40%. Things are changing very fast, and if the properties of aluminum alloy are not improved in near future, definitely this aluminum alloy will get replaced in aircraft. So I see a bright future of the smart materials. The outer elements of aircraft will become more skin-like, in that they will have to be strong, hard, rigid, and yet flexible, and the solution to all this is offered by smart material. Second is, the future is the energy sector, one of the biggest sector. Take the solar panels. Yes, aluminum again has got an important role to play. The channels in which solar panels are there is made up of aluminum. So we too had some experience of that. But again, the aluminum will be replaced by the smart materials. Think of a photovoltaic cell that can be painted on its surface or on the sheet. So that's the kind of a potential they have in the energy sector. Mobile industry, I was reading somewhere, now they are talking about self-healing glass. If you have a scratch for a period of time, that scratch will be removed by itself. So that's the kind of a wonder material which this conference is going to talk about. But all said and done, if you have to survive in this era of Industrial Revolution 4.0 with innovations in smart materials, we have to encourage students to think bold and embrace risk, do experimentation, ask them not to be afraid of failures. We must change their thought process. Again, I was reading somewhere that your thoughts become your karma becomes your habit becomes your character, and character becomes your destiny. So friends, let's pledge to make innovation of the smart materials our destiny. Again, I'll say the time has come with which we, during which we should take chances and should not be afraid of failures. If one is afraid of failures, is not prepared to do wrong, then you'll never come up with original. You'll be just copying whatever has been existing or whatever has been done. So what we are now is the dream of the past, and what we become in future is the dream of the present. So dream big, dream innovations, dream smart materials, and let me share with you that it is not the IQ, neither the intelligence, but the perseverance and the patience which matters. As you must be aware that success means going from failure to failure without losing enthusiasm. So that's the perseverance and the patience we have to have. Remember that nothing is permanent in this world, and my personal experience, I'm saying it's advice to all of you here, that whatever hard work you put in, it never goes waste. It will pay you not today, tomorrow, but definitely the day after tomorrow. So with that, I wish all the best to this ICS MAD 2021, and hope serious and sincere deliberations will be there for next 2 days on smart materials and its application. So with that, wish you all the success in your life and career. Thank you very much for inviting me. Thank you, and Jai Hind. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for sharing your deep knowledge with us. Your speech was full of enthusiasm and valuable knowledge. It will be a great pleasure for us to listen to you again in our future events. Thank you once again, sir. Now I request Honorable Dr. Mrs. Smita Vanjari, ma'am, treasurer of Amar Swamendra and Senate member of RTMNU, to address the gathering of this inaugural function. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Today's chief guest of international conference organized jointly by Department of Physics and Electronics, Honorable Dr. Anupam Agnihotri, sir, Director, Jawaharlal Nehru Aluminium Research and Development Center, and then President of Amar Seva Mandal, Honorable Dr. Suhasini Vanzari, Madam, then Secretary, Honorable अभिजीत वंजारी एमएलसी, प्रिंसिपल कमला नेहरू महाविद्यालय डॉक्टर डी एस पडवाईक सर, वाइस प्रिंसिपल डॉक्टर पी बी दईकर सर, कन्वेनर प्रोफेसर एस वी पोपुलवार सर, एंड ऑल द डेलीगेट्स हु आर पार्टिसिपेटिंग इन दिस यूनिक ऑनलाइन इंटरनेशनल कॉन्फ्रेंस ऑन स्मार्ट मटेरियल्स एप्लीकेशन टू डिवाइसेस. The medieval era where the stone, bronze, steel was used, now ceramic material, minerals developed from which metallurgical fields were born. Research on metal, alloy and silica and carbon nanometers has been researched in physics, chemistry, thermodynamics, electronics and many other areas of science. The 19th century marked the acceleration and wide adoption of industrial processes. At the start of the century, the Industrial Revolution was in mid-swing, and by the end, we had developed car and were just about to demonstrate power flight. The impact on the lives of humans was massive. Social and economic rules that govern travel, healthcare, manufacturing, working environments, and home life were rewritten. In 20th century, this process was repeated with the technological revolution, but at much faster rate. Technology moved from the laboratory and research institute to the home. The new realm of electronics, telecommunication, automation, and computation were the driving forces rather than the mechanical system of the previous century. In early 90s, there were almost no telephones, but at dawn of the millennium, mobile phones were an everyday sight. Computers were almost unheard of 100 years ago, but have become universal. We are now at cusp of new technology, shift of equal significance, the robotic revolutions. The revolutions will place the 21st century at a pivotal position in history. More importantly, it is irrevocable impact on all our lives and lives of future generations. Smart materials are the intelligence and responsive materials. Smart structures are tools made from smart material, capable of feeling external stimuli such as stress, moisture, electric or magnetic field, light, temperature, chemical components, respond to it and return to their original states after removing the stimuli. Smart materials will help reduce weight, component size, and complexity while improving design, flexibility, functionality, and reliability. In addition, they are impervious to water, moisture, dust, and other elements that can wreak havoc on electric motors. This significance of smart material and system is to allow existing technology to be improved using a smart material instead of conventional mechanism to sense and respond can simply devise reducing weight and chance of failure. Smart materials are the basic of many applications, including sensors, actuators, or artificial muscles, particularly as polymers, self-healing materials, magneting and thermoelectric materials, then polycarbolten, or emerging smart structures. Material science has now revolutionized the metal and alloy from semiconductor, plastics, biomaterials, rubbers, polymers, magnetic materials, medical implants, materials, nanomaterials, etc. It has not stopped yet. Smart material have huge market demands and future. The bio implant market close to 100 billion in 2018 and expected to reach 161.32 billion by 2024. By far, most of these are of or for human applications, although minority is for use in robotics for sensing. Smart materials and structures market is expected to cross more than 40 billion in upcoming years, and the market is segmented by product, end user industry, applications, and geography. In the industries, research and development investment, government assistance, research and defense in many universities, and adopt smart content product in many areas such as aerospace, automotive, healthcare, and consumer electronics has led to the market of smart goods. There are many promises in many areas of applications such as energy, architect, textile, ceramic, automotive, aerospace, equipment, medical, implant material, nano engineering material, shapes, memory, small fluid alloy, sensor, and actuators, and electronics industries in the future for these emerging materials. Today, the most promising technology for lifetime efficiency and improved reliability include the use of smart material and structures. Understanding and controlling the composition and microstructure of any new material are the ultimate objective of research in this field and is crucial to production of good smart material. This conference will certainly enrich your knowledge and wisdom. I wish all the best to the unique conference. Future is very exciting, new and advanced. Smart material will definitely solve various problems and smartly and enhance our quality of life. It's time to be smart. So thank you very much and happy learning to you all. Be safe, be at home. Please take care, wear mask, use sanitizer, be safe at your place. And I wish all the best to this conference. Thank you very much.
Am I audible? Ma'am, you have gone through a long journey of development of metals, say from stone to the smart materials, and also their applications in variety of applications also you explained. Thank you very much, ma'am, for such amazing and influential message. We are charmed by your short definition. Thank you once again. Now I invite Vice Principal Professor Dhaikar sir to propose vote of thanks.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Good evening to one and all. At the outset, I pay humble homage to great visionary leader, late Sri Govindrawji Vanzari, founder president of Amar Seva Mandal. It's my immense pleasure and proud privilege to propose the vote of thanks of this gracious inaugural function of International Conference on topic Smart Materials Application to Devices, jointly organized by Department of Physics and Electronics of Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya Nagpur. I, on behalf of Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya and entire organizing committee of this international conference, thankful to president of inaugural function and treasurer of Amar Seva Mandal, Honorable Dr. Smita Vanzari Madam, for presiding this conference and valuable guidance. Thank you, Madam. I am grateful to chief guest, Honorable Dr. Anupam Agnihotri, Director JNAR DDC Nagpur, for sharing knowledge with us and taking out time from their busy schedule. Thank you so much, sir. I am sincerely thankful to our beloved president of Amar Seva Mandal, respected Dr. Suhasini Vanzari Madam, for constant encouragement and guidance. I propose big thanks to Secretary of Amar Seva Mandal and MLC, Honorable Advocate Abhijit Vanzari sir, for kind inspiration and motivation. I would like to thanks to our principal sir of Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, Dr. Dilip Badwaik sir, for leading this event of conference successful. I congratulate to convener Professor Populwar sir and entire organizing committee for their hard work to make this event successful. At last but not least, I thank you all the participant for showing interest in conference. I once again thanks everyone for making this conference successful. With the permission of chair, I declare this inaugural function is over. Hand over to Karave madam. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for this, your proposing vote of thanks nicely. Now, we are going to proceed further for the first technical session. And I would like to invite Professor Praveen Sontakke, sir, to take the control of this stage and to start your keynote address.
Am I audible, madam?
Before leaving, I wish you all to be safe at home.
I think Dr. Joshi, sir, is joined.
Yeah.
Hello.
Joshi sir joined, sir.
Hello. Yes. I did.
Okay.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. Can you hear me?
Yeah, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Namaste.
And good morning to you, sir. You are from America and there is morning.
Yeah. It's about 6:30 now here.
6:30.
Very, very good morning, sir.
Sir, we force you to wake up early.
I had to wake up early today, but yes, that's okay. That's fine.
Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
Am I audible, sir?
Yeah, hello? Audible, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Is it so? You are you going to put my presentation there or
yeah,
how?
Sir.
Okay.
Yes,
no
yes,
problem.
Sir.
Your screen can be shared, sir.
Okay. Oh, you don't. You are not putting up the presentation. I have to share the screen. Is it?
Okay. No, yes, sir.
Sir, yes, has already sent the presentation.
I did send you presentation.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Yes.
He's there with us.
Yes, sir. It will present here, sir.
Okay.
The presentation will. Be
okay, shall I start, sir?
Yeah. Sir, you proceed.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you all. At the outset, I pay tribute to the memories of late Sri Govindrauji Vanzari, sir, the great visionary leader and the founder president of Amar Seva Mandal. Being a small organizing particle of this international conference, I, Praveen Sontakke, a faculty of Department of Electronics, of this outstanding institution, feel privileged to welcome you all. I heartily welcome our patron, Honorable Dr. Srimati Suhasini Vanzari Madam, President Amar Seva Mandal, Honorable Advocate Abhijit Ji Vanzari Sir, MLC Nagpur Graduate Constituency and Secretary of Amar Seva Mandal, Honorable Dr. Smita Vanzari Madam, Treasurer Amar Seva Mandal. I welcome today's speaker for the keynote address, Dr. Ashok Joshi Sir, Postdoctoral Fellow, Pennsylvania State University, USA Inventor and High Technology Entrepreneur. I welcome respected Dr. Dilip Badwaik Sir, Principal Kamala Nehru College, respected Dr. P.V. Dahikar Sir, Vice Principal Kamala Nehru College, Dr. S.P. Pupalwar Sir, Convener of this International Conference, Dr. Mrs. Vandana Kharabe Madam, Head Department of Physics, all the faculties, scientists, research scholars and students from all parts of India and from every corner of the world, I welcome you all. After the successful inauguration of this international conference, let's move towards the second important session of the evening of the day, which is the keynote address. And I, Praveen Sontakke, the Faculty of Electronics Department, wish to request respected Dr. P.V. Dahikar, sir, Vice Principal of this college, to introduce today's keynote speaker, Dr. Ashok Joshi, sir. Over to you, Dahikar, sir, please.
Good evening, once again, one and all. It is an opportunity to me to introduce eminent keynote speaker of this international conference, Honorable Dr. Ashok Joshi, sir. Dr. Joshi, sir, did his postdoctoral fellow in 1973 from Pennsylvania State University. He pursued his PhD in 1972 Northwestern University. He has completed his MS from Northwestern University in 1970. He is graduate BE from College of Engineering, Pune in 1966. There are so many honors and awards in his credit. Few of them are Pioneer of Progress Award for Science and Technology, Days of 47 State of Utah in 2014, and Maxwell Lifetime Achievement Award at the hand of Honorable Sharad Pawar. Utah Genius Award for the recognition of creative people behind Utah economy in 2012. Industrial Research Institute, Washington Achievement Award for exceptional work as an entrepreneur, scientist and philanthropist in the R&D industry in 2009. Utah ASEAN Chamber of Commerce Award, ASEAN of the Year 2009. Utah Government Medal for Science and Technology in 2004. India's National Small Business Entrepreneurship Entrepreneur Award by the President of India, Honorable Jhel Singh, in 1983, India's Perk Award for Innovation in 1982, invited speaker to various international conferences, including NATO Conference on Advanced Battery Technology in 1972. Dr. Joshi sir is a philanthropist engaged in the development and building of three schools serving 2,000 underprivileged children in rural India. One of the school focuses on mentally challenged children. He helped build a center for learning life skill for children in Mumbai slum area. He had donated for scholarship for students of the Salt Lake Community College. He collaborated with Westminster College for the Room to Read project to be implemented in a rural India village. He is one of the substantial donor for Hindu Ganesh Temple and the India Culture Center in Salt Lake City. Joshi is also actively involved in community development, serving on various boards. Board of Trustee, Salt Lake City Community College. India Cultural Center. Board member, Industrial Research Institute, USA. Board member and founder, Apollin Medical Corporation. Board member and founder, Active O Corporation. Co-founder, Calypto Medical Inc. President, Advisory Board, Westminster College. Co-founder, Eminence Inc. Founder and board member, Technology Holding LLC. Partner, Silvercrest Partner LLC. Dr. Joshi is a well-recognized innovator and high technology entrepreneur. Dr. Joshi has developed several technologies in the energy, environment, and biotech field. He is an inventor for more than 145 issues, US patent, and has over 20 pending US patent. He was responsible for commercializing 4 products. Dr. Joshi founded 6 other companies, of which he sold 3 companies and still run with an active interest in 2 other companies. Hope that all of you enjoy his talk. I request to Dr. Joshi sir deliver a talk on topic Microlin Control Release Technology Review. Hand over to Dr. Joshi, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, sir.
And can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so.
Please share your screen.
No. Sir, Mahajan, sir.
Mahajan, sir will be sharing your screen.
Yes.
Okay.
Mahajan, sir will share your screen, sir.
Okay, thank you. So, are you seeing the screen?
Yes, sir.
Just a minute. Mahajan, sir.
Is trying to share.
Okay.
Does he have?
Yeah, sir. He is having your presentation, sir.
Okay.
Is it possible, Mahajan, sir?
Sir, I think he is trying, but not cannot sharing here.
There is screen cover na jisse the tumki mujhe to Mahajan sir na dili hai na the presentation.
Oh, dili hai the na tena bhi phone kar rahe the bolna karta hai wohne. Ye bade wait nahi laga.
अच्छा मग दोन तीन ठिकाणी ठेवायला पाहिजे होतं ना हे. तो आपलाच व्हिडिओ वगैरे. त्याला फोन लावून तर पहा काय झालं तर.
काय
झालं तिथे डाउनलोड होऊन झाली ना झाली ओपन कर
नाही तर मी बोलतो असंच
सर
होते.
नो प्रॉब्लेम
बिकॉज ऑफ नेटवर्क इश्यू.
या दॅट इज द बिग प्रॉब्लेम विथ झूम कॉल्स एंड एव्हरीथिंग.
आशिष रेवतकर करतोय.
ओके या But let me tell you what I'm going to talk about at least.
Yeah, sir. By that way,
okay, yes, you may start.
Yeah. Microlin is a company which I purchased about 15 years ago. And it was in very bad shape. Now owned by a couple of large companies. And it was doing control release technology. So I thought that, well, I could buy that company on various loans. And I did that and turned it around and became a very successful company. So that's what I'm going to talk about. We developed several products, commercialized those products. And today, some of the products you will find in the United States, some of the products are in market. So that's what Microlin background is. But as I was hearing the last part of Professor Agnihotri's speech, and what he said is absolutely true, that lots of failures and some successes. That's the way life is. And even in India, when I started my button cell battery company, it was a colossal failure. But still, President Zail Singh decided to give me an award. And that was very surprising to me. So you know, what Agnihotri said is absolutely true. So Microlin is all about control technology. Control delivery of fluids, mostly control delivery of fluids. And lots of applications, actually. You can deliver fragrances. Okay, you got it. Wow. Okay, can you see now?
Yeah, sir.
Yeah.
My second slide. Yeah, so Microlin is all about control. And I'm not gonna go through all the slides. You will get the idea what I'm doing here. But I would say that if there are students and all that, I would say that what Agnihotri said, just try, just take the risk of doing it. I did it. And yes, there were a lot of failures, lots of failures, but you ultimately become successful. So Microlin, it's all about control delivery of fluids. Now you know that if you go in a hospital, they give you saline. And that bag, they adjust the delivery of fluids. But that fluid is almost like more than 10 cc per hour. What I'm talking about here, there is a unique opportunity where you can have 0.1 cc per day, 1 cc per day. And this is the unique technology that we developed, a technology that can deliver fluid under 1 cc per day, because there is nothing really available. My next slide. Are you going to control or me? So these are the consumer applications you can see. Fragrances, sanitizers, deodorizers, cleansers, insect repellents, drug delivery, and cosmetic applications. The next slide is really how do you deliver anything? So there are these gas cell technologies, and I'll explain to you what is that gas cell technology. There is an electroosmotic technology. There is an osmotic technology and on-demand pulse technology. My next slide. Go ahead, next slide. Okay. So gas cell, I will go to next slide and come back to this slide. Next slide, please. Okay, how does gas cell work? So here it is. Gas cell works such as it produces the gas controllably. And once it produces the gas, it pushes the whatever fluid you have out of the orifice. And that is basic principle of this. So how the gas cell works? You see the equation down there? It is zinc plus water with a catalyst of KOH produces hydrogen and zinc oxide. And so the fuel, this I call it fuel cell also, the fuel is zinc. It's like a battery. And most smart material, if you have to call, is the is really gas permeable protective membrane. And this is very crucial part of all this gas cell. The crucial part because it's supposed to let hydrogen out, but nothing else inside, because there are holes here which allows hydrogen out, but that permeable membrane doesn't allow anything else going in. For example, no hydrogen, no oxygen, nitrogen or moisture, nothing can go in. Only it releases the hydrogen. And that was pretty tricky to develop that. But rest of it is okay. And the most other important thing is, because you have to commercialize this gas cell, it has to be very cost effective for consumer to buy. So it became challenging, but we could make it. We make this cell under 20 cents per unit. And that it has about 18 different materials and parts to put together. This cell required a lot of efforts, but it cost less than 20 cents. And so the next slide, see, this is the side which is important. You see that tiny button cell? So that is actually like a battery, but it doesn't produce any electricity. What it produces is a gas. And that gas pushes that plunger. And that plunger pushes the fluid, as you can see. My next slide. So if you want to deliver, so I take this 50 cc device and you can see how controllably it delivers the fluid. Very controllably. You know, I don't know whether you know these fragrance delivery devices that are used in homes and bathrooms and everywhere. You really need to deliver only 0.2 cc per day, 0.2 cc per day. And that's why this was very important, that this gas cell can deliver just the 50 cc's in 180 days. 50 cc's in 180 days. So you can see the importance of this particular technology. The next slide. So this is a this is compared to whatever I compared this. There is a plug-in devices in the market, plug-in devices, and these devices really lose their efficacy in 15 days, as you can see from those red lines and yellow lines and so on. So they lose the efficacy in that. But you can see our devices, they just keep on going because the gas output is controlled with the resistor. And that's what it happens, is this gas pump can deliver the fluid at a controllable rate. So what you smell first day, you smell after 45 days, the same fragrance. And that is the idea here. Plus, you don't waste the fragrances, because that middle dotted line, once the fragrance delivery goes below that, you don't smell much. Anyway, the next slide. So you can actually deliver this in second, stage, weeks, months, or seasons. Deliver any fluid that you want to deliver. The next slide. So this is the pure drop fragrance, that every drop, you know, when you, all the devices on the market are based on wick devices. So there is a wick that brings up the fragrance, and then you heat that wick and delivers the fragrance. That's called plug-in. And I have seen the plug-ins in India too. But this device is basically very interesting, that the gas cell, you can see on the top of this device, there is a gas cell. And it delivers the fragrance drop by drop, the whole full fragrance. So you get the experience of full fragrance. The next slide. So we developed these two products. One is called T-cell and another one is called SaniCell. The next slide. The T-cell is, as you can see, I'm showing you this, is a gas cell, you can see that. And the fragrance is in that container. And then there is a orifice closure. That is also very important part that we designed. And as you can connect that gas cell with a resistor, the fragrances start coming out on the emanator, which is at the bottom. And that emanator, once it receives the drop, it releases that fragrance in the environment, whatever environment is there. My next slide. These are the products. So you will, if you come to US and if you see in the bathrooms, these are the products you see. And I understand that even in India, these are being marketed now. The next slide. So I made those products. So right now, up to now, in last 10 years, we made about about 8 crores product and sold it in United States market. And this, the bun which you are seeing is a Sanicell, which keeps the urinals sanitized. And it is also based on, if you see the middle, there is a, this gas cell on the top. It delivers at a 0.2. Yeah, this is the gas cell. 0.2 cc per day. And that is enough. So it is a very concentrated sanitizer. The next slide. So you can see on-demand gas cell is basically operated by the battery. And this is the battery here. This is the battery here that delivers the gas cell. It has the membrane is right here, and the water is there, and you apply the battery and produces efficiently the hydrogen and oxygen, both gases. And so it is a very high demand gas cell. It delivers, the difference between the other gas cell and this gas cell is that that gas cell can deliver only up to 10 cc per day. This gas cell can deliver 100 times more than the other gas cell. So the application really is in the home, bathrooms, rooms, small closed spaces, and as well as in the personal area, which is automotive, aromatherapy, personal fragrances devices. The next slide is osmotic technology. And osmotic technology is very interesting because the gas cell technology has one drawback. And that drawback is that it depends upon the temperature. As you know, the gas law, PV is equal to RT. So that volume of gas depends upon the temperature. In osmotic technology, that is not so. So in osmotic technology, there is a solvent, membrane, osmogen, expansion chamber, fluid reservoir, rate adjuster, and outlet. These are the parts. But the beauty of this is that it is a compressible fluid. So it doesn't depend upon temperature or any outside atmospheric pressures. So the next slide is how it works. So it depends upon your osmotic membrane, how thick it is, or what is the area of it. You can see that the rate depends upon that. And as osmogent, and osmogent is really a pure salt, and it draws that fluid, water, and that water pushes that membrane. And that pushes the fluid. And this is a very simple technology. The next slide. As I mentioned that it's insensitive to barometric pressure changes, much less sensitive to temperature, almost not even noticeable, controllable, no batteries or gas cell. It is very green, that means environmentally very friendly and very economical. The next slide is, as you can see, how controllable it is. It can deliver the fluid exactly like what I showed you in a gas cell. Next slide. So what we made a product out of it is for a home, Americans generally have plants. I'm sure that Indians have too, at their home. but you need little bit of fertilizer, especially for roses. If you want to grow roses, you need fertilizer. So we did this spike where we put in the roses, and every time you put the water in it on the top, it delivers slowly that fertilizer over a month period. So that's the product that we developed. The next slide. We also developed a fragrance delivery device, but we found out the market didn't accept this osmotic device because it is too large. You require as much water to deliver that much fluid. And so it became a too large a product. So people didn't like it. And so this product, especially the fragrance delivery device from the osmotic technology, failed. The next slide. So the conclusion is that osmotic reduces the sensitivity to environment. It can be controlled. And it's a viable alternative for certain applications, and not all the applications. So this is what we find out. The next slide. Deodorizing. This is very important, especially in when you are going out in a restaurant. All your clothes, especially if you are wearing jackets and all that, all your clothes get that food smell. So how every time you have to wash these clothes, and that's not necessary. So we developed a product which deodorizes. And what we use, I'll show you a little bit later, what we use is an ozone generator, tiny ceramic ozone generator, which releases the little bit of ozone, and that eats up all the smells. The next slide. Is in the atmosphere as well as tea and flea control. What we did with our gas cell, we developed a product that delivers tick and flea fluid on the pets, and that saves them from the tick and flea bites, and that keeps the pets quite healthy. Also in the beauty care, we developed iontophoretic technology, which I will explain. Okay, next slide. So these are the micromedical applications that are implantable device, which we developed for Medtronic Corporation, which is the largest corporation in the implantable device applications. Then we are still developing microneedle applications for vaccine applications. And especially it is right now very important. Iontophoretic devices that we commercialized for delivering the drugs, delivering the drugs for, you know, through the skin via electrical potential. And we also developed gas-driven fluid delivery devices for wound healing applications. These are the several applications we have divided. And we also developed negative pressure wound therapy application, which we sold that technology to Smith & Nephew. And that product, based on my patent, delivering about $1 billion per year revenue. Okay, next slide. I just wanted to make sure that you understand what iontophoresis is. Iontophoresis is actually is a device, which is a very simple device. You can operate it on a tiny button cell, which costs nothing. And you can deliver, for example, you have a tennis elbow. You can deliver a drug right where it hurts. And so the next slide. So you have to have a ionic drug. That is the requirement here. And there are hundreds of ionic drugs you can deliver. So positively charged active chloride particle, because either these drugs are sodium-based or chlorine-based. You can see the drugs. All the drugs are sodium-based or chlorine-based. And so since you have in body sodium chloride, you can take advantage of that and deliver a chlorine-based drug or sodium-based drug. And so you just have to put that drug on your skin and you can deliver right where you can do that. For example, even drugs like paracetamol, you can deliver those drugs through the skin. So you don't have to take those tablets. And so we developed these devices and now they are being sold in the United States. The next slide. So this is basically negatively charged active drug you can deliver. The next slide. So even in the active facial mask for the cosmetic applications, now many companies have developed iontophoretic devices to deliver some of the moisturizing drugs onto facial skins. So this is another application. Next slide. You see this Rachel, who used to be our administrative assistant, she is using one of our devices, which is iontophoretic brush that takes the cosmetic formulation and deliver it to her skin. The next slide. So you can deliver vitamins, antioxidants, pigmenting agents, moisturizers, and these are being commercialized in the United States. They are available in the United States right now. The next slide. We have also developed disinfection products, disinfection spray, disinfection wipes, and ozone disinfection container. The next slide. So we developed this spray, the spray nozzle. So you can use any bottle, and which has an electrochemical cell. That electrochemical cell can generate hypochlorite solution. So hypochlorite solution, you can do that. Just add the water in your water, little bit of salt from your kitchen, and you start that through the battery and you can generate a hypochlorite solution. And then you can spray on in your kitchen table or anywhere and it can disinfect. This is a very, very simple technology that you can use because you require only battery, simple battery, and salt and water. That's all you need. And you can use the tap water. The next slide. So we developed disinfection wipes. So you can see the electrodes, anode and cathode, and you can use again the same thing, the carbon electrode, so carbon paste, and anode, you can use the salt, or you can use just the zinc anodes. And you can generate hypochlorite solutions. So this is also pretty important technology in the wipes area. The next slide. That's how we use it right now, disposable wipes. But battery powered, of course, you need battery powered also. You can use it, just the two carbon electrodes and the salt solution, and you can use this. The next slide. So, ozone disinfection container. And there is this tiny ozone generator, the ceramic ozone generator, which has an active corona discharge generator. Very simple. Active corona, and that converts the oxygen into ozone, and that destroys all the bacteria that you have. The next slide. As you know, that the most oxidizing agent is hydroxy radical, but below that, this is ozone radical. We can generate hydroxy radical very easily. Okay, that's the corona technology. So this is a ceramic chip, which has a in between two ceramic chip in between. There is a layer of electrode, and this is an electrode. And when you apply a high potential, it generates the plasma here. This is a plasma, and that plasma generates, that's called corona, and that generates the ozone. The next slide. Yeah, so depends on if there is a hydrogen peroxide nearby, so it generates hydroxy radical. The next slide. The next slide. So we did a lot of biological test results, and we found that it basically destroys almost 99.99% bacteria. The next slide. So the applications for this is that you can imagine that you go to doctor's office, especially with kids, and they put the toys in the doctor's office. Anybody touches that and generates a lot of, they have a lot of bacteria on the toys. They can put that toys every day in the box and can clean those toys. Then you can, as I mentioned to you, that that deodorization of clothes, you can do that. You can deodorize the shoes, and you can also deodorize the cigarette smoke odor. The next slide. See how small that ceramic ozonator is. So, and this is the power source. And if you can put in the fuse, you can destroy all the odors. The next slide. The next slide. Okay. So what I showed you is that several applications, and that was my intent, is to show you the applications of just a simple technology, which is a controlled release technology. And I'm sure that the students who are listening to me, they can contact me and they can get some ideas and generate economic model that will help not only them, but for the community and India. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Thank you, Dr. Kishore Joshi, sir.
Not Ashok Joshi, Ashok Kishore. Joshi.
Yeah, hello.
Yes,
sir. Hello. Yes. Ha, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Is there any question from the participants? If there are any question, they can raise hand so we can allow them. Sir, can we take some question answer session?
Sure. You can. But what I said is that you can always contact me, any student. If they are entrepreneurial type, they can contact me and generate a company and all that. Okay?
Okay, sir.
May I ask you one question, sir?
Sure.
Sir, nowadays, coronavirus infections are everywhere, in environment also, and it is through air. Is there is any device through iontophoresis to control them?
No, iontophoresis is basically delivering the drugs through the skin. Yes. So actually, the next speaker, Dr. Karan Jekar, he is developing iontophoresis device to deliver the vaccines.
So
slow delivery of vaccines and different vaccines probably, so that you can do not get this coronavirus.
Okay.
But you can always, and also he is developing boxes for sterilizing instruments, materials, everything, boxes. That also is very important.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. If anybody, young people want to do some, start a company or everything, I'm available here. Okay.
Thank you.
I think Sonal Tripathi wished to ask question. Yes, please go ahead.
Very good evening, sir, since it is evening in India, and good morning to you, sir. It's a wonderful talk delivered by you. Since I'm an academician, I wish to ask one question related to consultancy services. With the concept of self-reliant India, the thought of Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi, how can we inculcate with these resources available with us, we can inculcate in the university so that our students can develop this kind of techniques with least expenditure?
That is a good question, actually. And I'm glad that you asked me this question, because this is exactly what is lacking in Indian universities. You know, sometime ago, 15 years ago, I was in Marathi channel Mi Maza with Kumar Ketkar, and he asked me the same question, that the Indian government spends so much money, but there is very little coming out of it as a separate companies. And I answered at that time that, you know, there should be a collaboration between the industry and academia. This is what is lacking in India, and this is what is prevalent, almost given, in Japan, US, everywhere. You really have to have this, because they will guide you. The industry folks will guide you, these young people, and they have an obligation to guide you. But apart from that, contact me. Because if they don't guide you, I will guide you. Because it's very important for India to get experiences from people like me who have commercialized various technologies. Of course, I failed 100 times. I failed. But as Agnihotri said, you know, failure is a part of learning. And I did learn that. So these young people, they have a tremendous energy, tremendous enthusiasm, and they can fail. They can fail. But they will learn. Okay. India has to do that. There is no other way. Academia and
industry. Permit.
Excuse me?
If you permit, you will please find the insights of you in future.
Yeah, absolutely. I didn't hear you quite bit. You were breaking up, but
I'm asking for your email ID. If the organizers permit, then please just update your email ID so that I can contact you. And with your expertise, we are going to definitely develop some kind of technology in the university also. Thank you so much, sir.
Professor Dahikar has all my info.
Yeah, sir. I will send it.
Yeah.
Okay. I think there are no more questions.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Sorry,
sir. I mistakenly taken your wrong name. Joshi, sir. Actually, yeah. In your talk, it was just a story of a microloan company which was not running well at start, and then you bought it and has done an excellent experiment over it and become a successful entrepreneur. So this is a really a great success story, and I think it will be definitely motivating for the students who are actually hearing it today. In your entire speech, sir, you discuss so many different products, and there are so many technologies actually, and then one technology which was the glass cell technology, which and all other like electro osmosis, and that the button cell, then micro, so many things that you have discussed in detail, that was really motivating for us, and such an excellent product that was used not only in the public area, personal use, in beauty care, in drug delivery. It was amazing, and I think it is motivating for all those who are in the research field. So it was a great experience for us to hear you, sir. Thank you so much for being here, sir.
Yeah, thank you. I think each technology requires one scientist to explain you the details of it. And but I thought that I would review it just to give you idea of how many products I touched. And that's what I did. And many more, hundreds of them. So thank you very much for having me as a speaker. And thank you, Professor Dahikar, and organizing committee and distinguished speakers. Thank you. Bye.
Sir, I once again thank you on behalf of Kamala Nehru College and entire college management. Thank you so much.
Right.
Sir.
Is Mukund joined? I'm sure.
I think sir is joined.
Okay. After the excellent keynote address by Honorable Joshi, sir, may I now request Mr. Devidas Sonkusre, sir, to conduct the next session. Over to you, Sonkusre, sir.
Mukund.
Karanjikar, sir. Dr. Karanjikar, sir.
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Good evening to you guys.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir, from India.
Absolutely.
Devidas Sonkusre, sir, are you there? Hello?
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, yes. Yeah. Please.
Yes, you are audible.
Good evening, one and all. I am Devidas Sonkusre, assistant professor at Department of Electronics. Behalf of Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, I am welcome to the next eminent speaker of the session.
Loudly. Please speak loudly.
Good evening, one and all. I am Devidas Sonkusre, Kamala, assistant professor at Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, Nagpur. Behalf of Kamala Nehru Mahavidyalaya, I welcome today's eminent speaker of this session, Dr. Karanjikar, sir, a president of Technology Holding LLC, Salt Lake, Salt Lake City, USA. Now I would like to invite Professor Sonthakti, sir, to introduce our eminent speaker.
Okay. Thank you, Sonkusre, sir. Being a co-convener of the international conference, I'm very happy to introduce honorable guest Dr. Mukund Karanjikar, sir. Dr. Mukund Karanjikar, sir, is the president of Technology Holding, a company that focuses on early stage technological ventures. He is passionate about innovations that leads to environmental and social sustainability. He also serves as a visiting fellow in energy innovations ecosystems at Harvard University and as adjunct faculty member at the University of Utah. He has been instrumental in creating spin-off companies based on academic innovations that have raised private capital and secured corporate partnerships beyond initial government funding. He has extensively overseen research pursuant to commercialization at a number of American universities and national laboratories, including MIT, University of California at Berkeley, University of Wisconsin, Harvard University, Drexel University, Texas A&M University, Lawrence Berkeland Oak Ridge National Laboratories. He is an inventor on more than 20 US and other international patents. He has co-authored a book titled Conquering Innovation Fatigue with Jeff Lindsay and Jerry Perkin, published by the Willey and Sons, New York. Why this is special? Because this book was recognized as one of the best reads by Business Week magazine. He routinely serves on panels at the US National Science Foundation, US Department of Energy, and has been a member of experts group on energy technology at the International Energy Agency. He was invited to serve on industry-inspired basic research panel by the Industrial Research Institute, an organization that constitutes a number of Fortune 500 corporations as its member, and to serve as energy business plan judge at the Gulf Coast Regional Center of Innovation and Commercialization, which is an initiative of Texas Governor Rick Perry. He also served on the bioenergy panel convened by the Bureau of Land Management of the Department of Interior. He was elected as the chair of the management division at the American Institute of Chemical Engineers, a membership organization with more than 40,000 members globally. He earned a Bachelor of Chemical Engineering from Institute of Technology, Mumbai in 1999, and PhD in Chemical Engineering from Auburn University in 2005. And this is a very small and short introduction of the honorable speaker, and I'm very confident that it will be a great experience to listen to. Thank you so much. So I request honorable Karanjikar, sir, to please start this. Over to you, sir.
Perfect. Thank you. Can you hear me properly?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You're okay. Very much audible, sir.
Excellent. Let me, well, thank you so much for the opportunity. Those of us who have PhDs on the call, we know that we like to hear our own voice quite a bit. So having this additional opportunity to hear my own voice just gives me a lot of pleasure. But more so, I'm very happy to share our experiences pursuing research topics in advanced materials with your students. I used to be young once upon a time, and I always wished that we had access to cutting-edge research. Of course, there were journals and publications, but it's not the same thing as hearing about it and ability to ask questions to the actual researchers and inventors behind these topics. I feel sort of jealous about today's student generation that they have an ability that we never did in our time to learn. And I hope they make the best use of it, and the privilege they have comes with the burden of advancing the overall state of the art in sciences even more. Because we could always hide behind the fact that we didn't have access to all the resources. Students today cannot do that. Everything is so much at their fingertips. So I hope you heard Dr. Joshi talk the previous call, and I hope you gather for the students, at least on the call, something useful from the work we do. So let me, the topic that I was asked to talk on is essentially nanofluidics transport through thin graphene membranes for rare earths applications. And I'll give you the background of the application and the material as well. But before I do that, let me acknowledge my collaborator, Professor Rohit Karnik of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Rohit and I have been working on, or better yet, MIT Technology Holding, have been working on this particular body of work for last 5-6 years almost. Very, very exciting to explore actual applications of high level of science that was done by Professor Karnik's lab. Nanofluidics, and indeed it sounds simple when you say graphene-based transport membrane, but the number of years and the excruciating details of science that have gone into it over a decade prior to we started working sort of formed the foundation. You heard in my bio, we sort of specialize in working with academic institutes to spin off companies and take that research sort of from, as we call it, research and development. So in the beginning, there is a big R and small D. So a lot of research, less development. But as you go more and more applied, you hope that the extent of research may remain the same, but the D becomes substantially larger. And that's what we do. We focus on the applied sciences, the technology and engineering, and science-based innovations are not linear processes, meaning there is a lot of feedback. You hit a wall all the time, and then you go back and you course correct. So it's not like you leave the science behind. A lot of people have misconceptions around innovation being a linear process. It most definitely is not that. It may be anything else, but definitely not linear. So you never really go away from science. And so that's the exciting part for those of us with science and engineering background. Even though you are leading these ventures and taking these technologies out of academic settings and taking them sort of into the future of applications, you always do cool science. So for those of you students, particularly on the call, who may have apprehensions that if you work in high sciences and you work in corporate slash private environment, then, you know, do you become sort of this mindless, objective driven person to do something worthwhile, meaning make money on innovations? That's kind of what companies call worthwhile. But for people in sciences, always remember there is never really a time in your life that you leave science behind. So with acknowledging my collaborator, let me begin. I'll give you a background of our company first. We are a fairly small company. We are founded in 2002. We have about 10,000 square feet of lab space in Salt Lake City, Utah. Six of our employees have PhDs, and the rest six are kind of their support staff, with 11 from inside and one person from the outside. That's the 12. Our focus largely is on advanced materials using various innovative fabrication techniques, whether it is material fabrication or it is molecular transformation. So molecular transformation as in traditional chemistry way or traditional biology way to produce innovative materials. And fabrication is just ability to use cutting edge tools and technologies to fabricate innovative materials that have sort of these, you know, high impact applications. We do fair amount of US federal contracting. We have private work as well, but a lot of it is US federal government. One thing good about the ecosystem I live in is there is a substantial federal government, which is called central government back home, support for innovative pieces of work, whether that is fundamental R&D or transition of those technologies into real world applications and performing the associated sciences work. So our projects are from the National Institute of Health, NIH, the Department of Defense, all major branches of defense, Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, Chem Bio Defense, etc., Department of Agriculture. We do fair amount of biofuel and bioengineering of microbes work. And that's why we have had traditionally programs for the from the Department of Agriculture. They are always looking for, you know, how can the farmers in the country derive additional revenue from non-crop biomass that occurs on their field. And there is a lot of forestry in the US that has requirement that certain amount of biomass, you know, it's called maintenance of forest. You just don't let the trees grow infinitely like weed. You have to manage it. And so there's a lot of thinning. So millions and millions of metric ton of biomass that's produced every year. We have programs from Department of Energy, particularly the graphene work I'll talk about is funded by them. And there are other pieces of work we have funded by DOE. And then we don't do much of a National Science Foundation work these days, but in the past we had a number of programs from the National Science Foundation. And how do we accomplish, you know, it appears for a small company like this, 11 employees, six PhDs, how do you do so much work? Just the number of agencies, if you do one award per agency, that appears a lot of work. And the way we do that is we collaborate with best of the minds in business. And by business, I mean research and development. So these best of the minds are at various national labs and universities. As I mentioned, this particular piece of work, the one on graphene, I am engaged with the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and Technology Holding has a broader collaborative partnership with MIT. And there are many other universities and national labs we work with, Tufts, Johns Hopkins, Rice, Princeton, University of Utah, Harvard, LBNL, the Bio Research Center, Joint Bioenergy Institute, and there are a few other universities that are not listed here. But the intent is work with best of the minds, bring the applied engineering, applied sciences perspective to the linearity and circularity of innovation, and you innovate much faster like that. So that's about the company. Let me give you a couple of examples that are not related to graphene, so sort of demonstrate the breadth we do. And since I did talk about a few other things we do other than graphene. So this particular piece of work we have in collaboration with Princeton and the US Navy. So essentially, all of us know that planes are not going to fly on electricity anytime soon. I am sure you hear read a lot about electric cars sort of as a way for sustainable transport away from petroleum-based gasoline we call in the US, it's called petrol back home, and also diesel for passenger cars. A lot of pollution problems, greenhouse gas emissions problems for climate change. India is a signatory and so is United States. Very recently, we joined after 170 countries joined the Paris Accord that you may have heard, where there is collaborative efforts across the globe to keep the planet from heating about 2 degrees centigrade and better yet 1.5 degrees centigrade. And that way we can continue to exist as a human race. I have a lot of faith in our ability to innovate our way out of here. Although we have sort of not demonstrated that exactly as a civilization when it comes to management of pandemic, whether its ability to not get infected or ability to do drug development fast. However, given enough time, we dig ourselves out of all sorts of problems, whether it is famine or flood or hurricanes or pandemics or climate change, which is a multi-generational problem. So one other thing, those of you who are engineers on the call and scientists both actually, that are not solving information technology problems, meaning not developing the next Twitter or Facebook. The news I have for you, and it's not much of a news because you probably share and sympathize with me, the types of problems we work on, sort of the first time constant of solving those problems, meaning doing anything impactful in what we do as deep tech sciences people is larger than one natural lifespan. And so please don't get discouraged if you work on something that kind of doesn't reach to fruition over a decade or even 2 decades, because these problems are very, very long term. So let's talk about aviation fuel for a moment. Aviation as an industry, you know, since 1900, so 120 years of existence, so many innovations, but we still fly on hydrocarbons, right? And that's how hard it is. This slide shows we are playing our part. So we have engineered these microbes that you express certain heterologous genes, as they are called, meaning it's not a genetic matter from the bacteria itself when you ferment. So you take that, you express these specific chemical producing genes, you catalyze the product you make called isoprene, and you make jet fuel blend. The beauty of this is fully bio-derived. You have 4.5% higher energy density. That doesn't appear like a big number, but it's sort of a very big deal because you just don't make dense hydrocarbons like that. You have to be innovative, like make 8 carbon rings, as you see here. And then all of, you know, the overall impact of all of this is on reduction on and potential elimination of carbon dioxide, a greenhouse gas at the center of this whole Paris Accord debate. So that's one particular innovative project. We are at the cusp of taking this project to a demonstration scale. We have a partnership with a large aircraft manufacturer who is going to fly an entire aeroplane on our fuel very soon, and kind of it's considered a substantial advance to be able to have an experimental flight like that. It's a luxury to have. It costs, you know, multi-million dollars just to do one experimental flight, and we are excited with this particular partnership. So that kind of just speaks to the transition of the work. The second piece of work, same thing, we engineer different bacteria to express different genetic matter to be able to produce spider silk, essentially what a spider will weave when it makes its web. You can take the genes from the spider, so you don't really kill the spider. You know, you can sequence the spider genetic matter. And people have done this work. So by no means we are the first ones. We're just doing the applied engineering and technology development of it. But the faculty member at Utah State University, we had collaborated with Professor Randolph Lewis. He had done this work over 40 years before we started working on sequencing the genetic matter of a spider, taking the necessary genes that are responsible for spinning the silk for weaving the web they do, and then taking that and expressing that into bacteria, and then taking the genetically engineered bacteria and producing what are called these protein materials that are now akin to the basic building block of synthetic spider silk. So it's essentially as if a spider would make it, but in a synthetic environment. So, you know, for us engineers, we like to take things into controllable industrial paradigm. And that's what we do. The idea is to industrialize production of these natural wonder materials, because something cool about silk is it is tougher than Kevlar and stronger than steel. And so very, very unique and novel material. And we have been able to, you see some pictures there on the slide, we've been able to demonstrate mats and fibers and fabrics made from it. So with those two as sort of related but not quite related examples to the title of the talk, let me jump into sort of the background of why we started working on graphene nanoporous membranes. It sounds like a technologically intensive work, but where is the application space? So if you look at industrialization paradigm, particularly for chemical process industry, what you see is we have figured out how to make molecules from other molecules, but we haven't quite figured out how to properly separate them, the desirable from undesirable, or one desirable from another desirable. So our tool is essentially, oh, let's boil it, right? So that's kind of the grandfather's era technology is distillation. And people have done, I mean, I don't, by no means I am belittling distillation, but boiling cannot be solution to everything. So you boil things, and problem is the amount of energy that you expend on boiling one item from another. So let me give you a simple example, ethanol fermentation, right? So whether it is ethanol for fuel application or ethanol for industrial applications or ethanol as a human consumable, what you do is you ferment it in a pot. And you get ethanol sort of anywhere between 1% to 10% in concentration. And now what you have to do is you have to boil out the ethanol. Imagine the pot you have to boil. If it is 1%, for 1 liter ethanol recovery, you are boiling 99 liters of water for no particular purpose. 99 liters of water boiled, you just add the sensible heat going to 100 degrees centigrade and the latent heat after that, because you're always going to have vapor pressure of water ethanol, and it forms an azeotrope. So it makes your life even more miserable. So you do an azeotrope, you take the azeotrope, and now you do adsorptive separation to try to purify ethanol. And you know, if you look at the total energy intensity of processes like that, there is no fun in saying that we are doing anything sustainable. So what you can look at is anything that has distinction in molecular sizes. So one molecule is larger than the other is one way to look at it. or one molecule is more polar than the other is another way to look at it. One molecule forms a higher or a bigger diameter of hydration, meaning how it associates with water molecules around it versus the other. So you look for these signals in molecular mixtures to separate one from the other and try not to boil it. So that was kind of our marching orders, is how can you do separations without boiling? And the problem becomes infinitely worse. You see the graph there on the right-hand side bottom. I don't know if you can see my mouse, but that's desalination. So we have populated the planet to 7 billion, very close to going to 9 billion. A number of countries with large coastal areas, but not much of water. I know India is in that zone, whether the water table kind of is depressing lower and lower. And we have a big coastal line. United States is exactly the same thing. And a lot of countries in the Middle East, Africa, you look at, they don't even have water tables. I mean, they have to rely on, I mean, they do, but it's very, very deep. They would rather, you know, pump out petroleum than water. And so you take that ocean water and you have to do desalination. So look at the green graph versus thermal desalination. This kind of goes to show the impact membrane technology can do. And that's only one example of China. And globally, the graphs are sort of similar because you look at the desalination capacity, the purple slash blue looking, I don't know, screen shows different colors, different places, but this is growth in desalination capacity. Look at the Chinese growth in desalination capacity for membrane desalination versus thermal desalination. And membrane desalination is infinitely more. And these membranes are not even selective. These membranes work off of distinction between kinetic transport, meaning, you know, one molecule runs faster than the other molecule through a body of polymeric material. There is no selectivity to it. So if you look at the future, what you want is highly, highly selective membranes. So your pressure to drive the membrane separation goes down. And at the heart of all of this, you have to go away from distillation as a prevailing paradigm of separation. So kind of with those two as our guiding tools, let's take a look at what are the opportunities for membrane processes. So you must have seen many of these various membrane processes. So particle filtration, like beach sand or milled flour or bacterial separation. So to the right of it is particle separation. These are multi-micron size. Microfiltration are single digit micron size. Nanofiltration are submicron but supra nano. And then reverse osmosis is truly a diffusion based membrane transport, but there is so much space to replace out pieces of reverse osmosis polymeric membranes and make nanofiltration slash ultrafiltration selective to further reduce the enthalpic load, whether it is driving pressure or sometimes driving temperature, to get them down. So, you know, if you look at basically the paradigm, the thermal processes, energy intensive membrane processes, low energy, they are tunable, they are modular. Thermal processes, you cannot do that. You have to have large plants. It's all about, as I mentioned, boiling, distillation. And so the innovation is selectivity of transport that uses molecular size distinctions. And that's exactly what graphene does. Graphene otherwise is a non-porous full wall of a material, meaning you hit it with anything, it does not break. The innovative piece of work Professor Kernick's lab had done at MIT is create porosity in a size that is desirable for separating. In the beginning, this work was exclusively focused on desalination, so salt, so sodium chloride, and water separation. And those of you who have stronger penchant for deep research, just look up Rohit Karnik's profile in Google Scholar or elsewhere. You'll see a lot of nature slash science publications from him, a lot of nanotechnology publications that describe all the fundamental aspects or aspects of the science much more in depth. So graphene is atomically thin. So it's truly sub-nanometer. The other problem with membranes is they have to be thick. And as you get thicker membrane, you know, the transport coefficient multiplied by the distance it has to travel, whether diffusive or pore flow, you're going to have higher back pressure and higher energy to drive it. So to make it more and more sustainable, you have to have thinnest possible membrane, which is what graphene is. And so you make these rigid defined pores via innovative fabrication techniques, as I talked to you about in our opening monologue. We do a lot of innovative fabrication methods. So there is a known fabrication method called gallium ion bombardment. There is also oxygen transport plasma. There is uranium hexafluoride bombardment, which give you rigid and defined pores. So now you have essentially a screen of graphene that is predefined for certain porosity sizes. And that's where the graphene material plays a role. You see that, I don't know if this is obvious to you, between 1 and 10 nanometer, which is the hardest to do separations without having a very high pressure drop and therefore no selectivity, just kinetic transport. And that's not very, very desirable. So graphene takes you away from, or nanoporous atomically thin graphene takes you away from the paradigm of pressure-driven filtration and the kinetic separations to truly, it's a strainer that separates tea from water. Simplest possible sort of macroscopic example that you can make it analogous to. The general fabrication process is, how do we realize the potential is, you graphene, there are manufacturing companies these days that sell you graphene on a copper substrate. So it gets deposited via chemical CVD, chemical vapor deposition, on a graphene substrate. And they sell you basically a plate of on a copper substrate. And they sell you basically a plate of graphene on copper substrate. Graphene is fully transparent. You cannot see it. So to those uninitiated, not on this call, other people who don't work in sciences, they cannot even distinguish if there is actually a graphene layer on the copper. And then there are innovative methods we have developed to peel off, for the lack of a better word, or delaminate the graphene from copper and then laminate it on a polymeric substrate. Because remember, this is atomically thin. You cannot handle the material. And so you have to transport it from one substrate to another substrate. So in this case, the polymeric substrate acts as a rigid support for the graphene, but does not interfere with the transport phenomena. What you have is a monolayer of graphene. Now it is ready for these gallium ion or other types of bombardments to be made into a ready material for actual stream-based membrane separation. This just shows you in depth of what I described to you. There is the point behind this particular slide is a lot of people had a number of questions in the past, which are kind of led to rest now, that can you actually manufacture graphene membranes like we manufacture textiles or we manufacture polymeric membrane, basically they call it roll to roll. And a number of researchers at MIT and elsewhere have demonstrated that graphene itself, so our work begins after graphene is fabricated, but graphene itself can be manufactured as a roll to roll material. The cost of manufacturing at a scaled up level could be less than $10 a square meter, which is a pretty big deal. A lot of the solutions and materials we use post facto, meaning after graphene is produced, all of those could be recycled, thereby further enhancing the cost efficiency of the process. And so all in all, very, very scalable innovation, even if it starts with a high fancy science material to dimensional atomically thin carbon material and initially produced using sort of these fancier fabrication methods, but very much scalable, can be taken to industrial transport paradigm. As you can see here, initial pore creation, and you see these bar graphs that are pore counts, and they go narrower and narrower as you go more and more controlled. And that's what you want. You want it almost like a delta function in porosity ultimately, and reduce the variability in pore sizes sort of permanently. And that's what this particular graph shows. You can, this was sort of, model work. As you can see, some of the ions, and forgive me if some of this is not very readable, a potassium ion is at 0.66 nanometer, Allura red is at 1 nanometer. And what you show, what you can see here on the normalized flux, that you can almost very, very selectively separate out Allura red and leave potassium chloride back. So now you have essentially demonstrated, let potassium chloride go through and leave Allura red back, which is at about 1 nanometer. So see here at 5 minutes, you have zero molecules. This is pictorial representation, but this is actually off of measured concentrations. You have zero molecules of potassium, of Allura red making through potassium chloride. So you distinguish between 0.66 and 1 nanometer. Polymeric membranes or any other type of membranes will not do that. 10th of a nanometer distinction is not possible. And that's very, very exciting about this piece of work. So some other things you can discern from it, and you can almost model the pore size distribution here using sort of the resistance model, because the pores are non-resistive and the solid block material are sort of fully resistive. Sometimes there are defects, they may not be fully resistive, etc. But the idea was to demonstrate sort of initially centimeter scale. So, you start with millimeter scale, then you scale it to centimeters out of one factor. It still had very, very highly efficacious high permeance transport, yet highly, highly selective using centimeter scale prepared membranes from oxygen plasma etching. As I mentioned, there are gallium ion bombardments and uranium hexafluoride bombardments as well. The flux is a key component because what you want to do, the problem with what reverse osmosis is, your recovery is very, very low, meaning no point in taking 10 liters out of a 1,000 liter bath and say we have purified water. The problem is you have also left 990 liters behind. What you want to do is you want to get high degree or high selectivity of separation, but also high flux, which is expressed as liter per square meter per bar. And there is a time unit you can do per hour or per second. But the idea is how much water or fluid can you flow across the membrane in the shortest possible time on a smallest possible membrane, and with application of lowest possible pressure, which will give you economies at scale. And you can see this graph here. We get very, very high selectivity, almost pristine rejection of Allura red from water. Again, remember 1 nanometer separation, 90% plus selectivity at very low pressures and very high fluxes. As you can see, these fluxes are 10 to the power 5. If you were to, essentially that's, 100 LMH per bar roughly. If you were to get polymeric membranes, you are going to get less than 1 LMH per bar type of fluxes, so almost two orders of magnitude. The graphene membranes, they withstand high pressure. That's kind of the intent behind this slide. A lot of the time people are akin to thinking that, okay, so if it is a you know, reverse osmosis processes that are done at 80 bar and graphene is atomically thin, does it withstand pressure? As you can see, it can withstand 300 bar or longer. Remember, graphene is a two-dimensional network of carbon-hydrogen atoms, and it's extremely strong. There are a lot of potential applications of it. And let me jump into one particular use case. We are getting to the end of the time here. Rare earth material. So as I talked about, you know, our intent behind sustainable innovation and this paradigm of energy innovation, going from petroleum driven engines to electricity driven engines. The problem is these electricity driven engines use these electric motors and magnets that use rare earth materials, and there aren't enough rare earths around. Most of it is all of us, that is India and United States, come to depend on China for these materials. And we have seen with pandemic and other things, it's important to have self-sufficient supply chains, whether it is United States or India, or at least go away from countries with origin of pandemic type viruses. It is desirable to not deal with such places. And so self-sufficiency of rare earths is important. There is manufacturing of rare earths and there is recovery of rare earths. The recovery part is absolutely horrendous. I would rather get into the business of mining rare earths than recovering, because you look at these extraction processes. So you get this ore, you dissolve it in high acid, meaning high pH, either hydrochloric or sulfuric or nitric acid, or better yet, mixtures of those. And now you made what's called pregnant leachate. So that has all sorts of materials, rare earths, this, that. And then you take those and one element at a time, you do the solvent extraction. These solvent extraction tanks are huge. I mean, they put a refinery to shame in terms of the size of the tank farm. 27, 30, 50 extractors in series of each other. It's not a joke to say that you actually, eventually you will start needing an actual airplane to fly from one tank to another tank. Right now you have to get into a car to do that. And that's kind of the industrial paradigm. You know, I call those grandfather's era technologies, extraction. It's pointless. To some degree, it has a meaning, but to do it on a bulk level where you are handling millions and millions of cubic meters of liquid and you are solvent extracting it, I mean, you know, which side of the bed did you wake up on? So we are looking at, okay, can you do this highly selective separation where you rely on distinction between molecular diameters of rare earths, which are traditionally larger elements, and some of the salts, sodium chloride, potassium chloride, magnesium chloride, calcium chloride, that you can either think of precipitating or you actually separate those as well via differentially sized graphene membranes themselves. Depending on which technique we use to create porosity, we can actually get differentially sized, highly selective, high flux membranes. And as you can see here, this particular bullet says we have up to 60, so 58 LMH per bar flux. That is pretty neat. As I mentioned, polymeric membranes are at one. Conventional nanofiltration membranes, which don't work for this application, but just for comparison, are less than 10 LMH per bar. And we have shown sort of neodymium, one of the key rare earths that goes into what's called iron neodymium boron magnet, which is a key to an electric motor or windmill. Anything that moves with electricity, those magnets are there. World is essentially in short supply. And we have demonstrated in three stages, we can separate out neodymium, more than 99% of it. You'll never get perfect separations, right? The world is not a perfect place. You'll always have continuity. So you can leave behind even gold mining, right? Those of us who know mining, gold, you don't refine all the gold. And that's why there are these heaps and heaps of mining waste outside of gold mines that still has a lot of gold. I mean, you cannot get rich off of it because the cost to refine it is lower than the cost of selling of or the price of gold. Same thing with some of these rare earth materials too, but we can recover 99% of it with highly selective membranes at high flux. And so you have seen this before, but we could do diffusion-based or pressure-driven. We established the pressure-driven filtration in our lab. I'll wrap up in 3 minutes so that we have 10 minutes for Q&A at least, and demonstrated that graphene by itself doesn't transport anything. So that means you made a pristine membrane. Here is some data to back up our claims, 24-hour long separations, demonstrating the permeance over and over, that membranes work quite fine there. You can see this picture. This is sort of just for naked eye. You can make the observation that one is the retentate, one is the permeate. You can see neodymium sodium chloride separation. Sample three, you know, there is no salt, very little sodium chloride goes through. And as I mentioned, in three different stages, we build this number up to 99%. The idea on this particular slide is we want to take our work to multi-elemental like rubidium and some of these other fancy material, lithium for lithium ion batteries. Lithium has a hydrogen diameter that goes to 0.9 nanometers with chlorine. And so that gives you sort of some prospects of separating those, but we have demonstrated 10 plus cationic carrier ions we could separate from water and sodium chloride. So, ways to go, of course, those, as I mentioned, the timeline for solving some of these problems. If you do something in a decade, you will be the lucky one. These are long-term multi-generational problems to work off of, but I'll stop there and open the floor up for questions. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, sir. If you have some questions from the participant, you can ask. Hello.
Hello.
If you have some questions, ask. Okay, sir. Ask your question.
There is one question from my side.
Yeah, you can.
Hello.
Hello, Sudesh.
Am I audible to you?
Ask the question.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Yeah, sir. How we can separate out the butanol and like that compound from biomass in an easy way?
I think butanol separation, unfortunately, the molecular sizes are not that distinct from each other. So you will, PTFE or silicolite type of pervaporation based membranes. We do have a project on butanol actually where we do pervaporation. So, you just apply vacuum on the other side, you get very high concentration of butanol to the point that it separates itself from water. And then you essentially just phase separate. We have recent work in, and I can send you the paper, to separate one hydrocarbon from another hydrocarbon, which are distinctively molecularly sized. You can do, but butanol water, the molecular size difference is not appreciable to use nanoporous graphene membranes.
Sir, I am working on enzymatic degradation of the biomass, and we are getting sometimes propanol, sometimes butanol after varying time or exposure time. Would you like to share your mail ID for further communication?
Absolutely. I would love to help. Absolutely. Dr. Dahikar has my contact information. I don't know if it is on the last slide here, but he has the contact information.
Yes, sir. I will communicate to him.
Perfect. Thank you.
Definitely, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Sure.
Hello. Thank you, sir. Sir, can I ask one question, sir?
Please.
Hello. Sir, how much small size of the graphene is there to filter out the air particles?
How you mean? How small can we get the distinction between?
Yes, sir.
0.1 nanometer. So 10th of a nanometer.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Now I'd like to invite Dr. Populwar, sir, to give their concluding remarks, sir. Over to you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Devidas. First of all, Dr. Tanjikar, Professor Tanjikar sir very well explained his novel research work on nanofluidic transport across nanoporous atomically thin graphenes. He has very well explained vital role of rare earths in the industries, including renewable energy, electric variable vehicles, and superconductors, etc. Dr. Karanjikar has a project, means innovative project, on separation method for rare earths, which developing versatile and cost-effective method for rare earth elements. He has also developed a method which is based on atomic scale pores in ultra thin and ultra strong graphene membrane, and its size is nano size, means 1 to 10 nanometers. And he suggested his further target to research is to demonstrate high selectivity towards higher rare earths separation from heavier ones to heavier ones, leading to replacing solvent used for extraction. And this his work is very nice, and there is a novelty. One thing, for the fuel, sir discuss here is suggested that the his project under his project the he developing aviation fuel produced from biomass. So for the purification, he used graphene nanoporous materials, and by using this membrane, there is the separation of the by using this separation method, he used the rare earths. I'm very thankful, Dr. Mukund Karanjikar sir. He has very well explained and given knowledge about this new advanced materials. So I'm very thank you Karajikar sir. Thank you. Now here declare Miss, we will again meet Miss, we will welcome you all participants tomorrow at 3 o'clock. So tomorrow there are 3 talks by different resource persons. So first talk will be delivered by Professor Pode sir at 3 o'clock. At 4 o'clock, Professor Kaple sir, and Kaple sir from Nepal, and Pode sir from South Africa, South Korea. And third talk will be delivered by Professor Ajit Kaushik from Florida, USA. So there are 3 invited talks tomorrow. So we'll meet again tomorrow 3 p.m. So thank you.
One thing, sir, we can take one snap photo so that I request to all participants, please on your video so that commonly we can take one photograph. Is it possible? Ashish? Dr. Ashish?
Ashish?
Yes, sir. Hello, sir.
Yes. You can take one photograph.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Common photograph. So I request to all participants, including resource person, please on your video.
Okay, sir.
Participants are requested to on their videos.
Okay.
Riyotkar, have you snap photograph?
Yes, sir. I just took it. Okay, sir. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Thank you to all.
Sir Baker, sir. Winding here,
yeah.
Okay, thank you. Thanks to all participants.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Karanjikar, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Karanjikar, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Good night.
Thank you,
sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Ranji sir, thank you for accepting our invitation.
Thank you. Thank you. No, I'm happy.
See you again, sir, in future.
Absolutely. Let's do this in person one of these days. So
right. Yes.
There will be offline conference. So you will be offline.
We are definitely inviting you for in that conference.
Absolutely, I would love to. Yes,
we will invite you.
And we will decide it as per your convenience.
Oh, I'm happy either way. I get to see my mom, so I don't mind flying back just because of the pandemic. I can't. So yeah. Okay.
Perfect. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. Bye. Bye.
Bye.
Okay.
Bye, sir.
Okay, sir.
Devotkar.
Hello, sir. Hello.
Wind up. Okay. Wind up. Karo.
Oh, sir, you are the host. You close the meeting, sir. Popular, sir. You are the host now.
Majakade ka.
Ha, sir. You are the host.
Okay.